So it was retrieved. Hola, buenas tardes. Me da mucho gusto darles la bienvenida a nuestras dos últimas mesas y a la conferencia magistral. Y sin muchos preámbulos, la gente que nos sigue en línea, por favor, no olvide mandar sus preguntas conforme vaya escuchando a las y los ponentes y les ponentes. Y los dejo con Leslie Wurf, que va a moderar la mesa que sigue. Buenas tardes.
Gracias, Debra. Sí. Muy buenas tardes a todas y todos. ¿Me escuchan bien?
Sí.
Ok. Vamos a empezar con el sexto panel de esta conferencia. Primero, quiero decir gracias a Giovanna Jasperson y al Museo Franz Mayer para su hospitalidad. Estamos muy contentos de estar aquí en el museo para el día final de este encuentro. Entonces, soy Leslie Wolf, la vicepresidenta de ALA, y tengo el placer de moderar el sexto panel de, que se titula Redefining the Archive, Performance and Video Art, o Redefinir el Archivo, Performance y Video Arte. We will hear from four presenters, Madeline Murphy Turner, Joseph Shekwitz, Cecilia González Colino, and Benjamin Murphy, who have very exciting work to share with us today. After the final presentation, we will have time for questions and discussion, as Deborah mentioned. Our first presenter is going to be Dr. Madeline Murphy Turner. She is an independent art historian and curator based between New York City and Buenos Aires. Her work centers on contemporary art in Latin America, with a special interest in topics of ecology, gender, and performance. In January of 2023, she received her PhD from the Institute of Fine Arts, New York University, congratulations, where she submitted a dissertation titled What Women Write, Artists' Books, Postal Objects, and Independent Theater in Mexico City, 1979 to 1992. Today, Madeline is sharing a presentation entitled Performance, Politics, and Protest in the Jesusa Rodriguez Papers. Madeline.
Thank you, Leslie. ¿Me escuchan todos? Sí, gracias. Hola a todos. Muchísimas gracias, Leslie. Es un gusto participar en este foro con ustedes hoy. Antes que nada, quería agradecerles a todos los organizadores por este congreso tan lleno de intercambios enriquecedores. Espero recibir sus preguntas después de mi charla, porque esta presentación forma parte de una investigación todavía en curso. Así que sí, espero sus preguntas y las pueden realizar las preguntas en castellano o en inglés, por favor. Y ahora voy a cambiar al inglés. Okay. Since the late 1970s, the Mexican director, actress, and politician Jesusa Rodriguez has been a critical figure in the performance scene of Mexico and abroad. She has implemented performance as a way to challenge hegemonic power through activism and sharp humor from her creation of the female theater group Divas AC in 1980 to her position as the first openly lesbian Mexican senator from 2018 to 2021. In 2011, with the help of performance studies scholar Diana Taylor, New York University bought the Jesusa Rodriguez papers. Spanning from 1977 to 2019, the papers contain photographs, newspaper clippings, scripts, and other documents, and you're seeing the finding aid on screen right now. Among the items in the Jesusa Rodriguez papers are materials dedicated to Rodriguez's 1987 to 1988 play, El Concilio de Amor, Tragedia Celeste, or The Council of Love, A Celestial Tragedy in English. Her production was an adaptation of the late 19th century theatrical work by the German playwright Oskar Panizza, which was titled, in English translation, The Council of Love, A Celestial Tragedy in Five Acts. The play tells the story of God, the Virgin Mary, Jesus Christ, and the devil conspiring to punish humans by creating syphilis. In Rodriguez's interpretation, sexually transmitted illness took on a new meaning with the AIDS epidemic. A comment on contemporary society that transcends generations, The play received significant backlash from the Catholic Church and politicians in both the 19th and 20th centuries. The Jesús Rodríguez Papers holds photographs, programs, and reviews of Rodríguez's productions of El Concilio de Amor. However, most of the documents reveal the work to be one of four artistic events that Pro Vida and other Mexican conservative right-wing Catholic groups protested in early 1988. In the papers, newspaper clippings, legal documents, and personal letters unfold the relationship between art and censorship. And you see some examples on screen of the documents that I will be talking about. And as a side note, I appreciate your patience with the low quality of these images that I'll show, which is due to time and financial constraints. In this presentation today, I propose a reading of El Concilio de Amor that expands our understanding of the work. I argue that the Jesús Rodríguez paper shifts our interpretation of what it means to reconstruct a performance through documentation. Looking at specific documents, I suggest that the papers show us that the archive can not only attempt to reconstruct or refer to the performance's content, but rather expand its political scope by altering its interpretive framework. I will start by sharing some background information on the Jesús Rodríguez papers and El Concilio de Amor. Then I will show some of the documents in the papers that speak directly to the production itself, before contextualizing the play within the socio-political moment of early 1988. Next, I will move on to the main examples that support my thesis, which are the documents in the Jesús Rodríguez papers that address this topic of censorship. And then finally, in the conclusion, I will consider how these documents help us rethink the function of a performance archive and the performance itself, before moving to a coda that brings the topic of artistic censorship into the 21st century. With the support of Diana Taylor, who is a friend and the main scholar on Jesús Rodríguez, the papers were sold to New York University's Tamamit Library and Robert F. Wagner Labor Archive in 2011. And here, as a side note, we could return to the question of accessibility, which has been raised by a number of our colleagues over the past couple of days with archives leaving their country of origin. The Tamamit Library and Wagner Labor Archive is not an art archive, that's important to emphasize, but rather a collection that holds materials of all formats that document labor, the left, radical politics, and social movements, especially anarchism, communism, and socialism. All the papers at NYU bought were selected and saved by Rodríguez herself, and the collection was first processed in 2019. During processing, various series were created and ordered, quote, according to the natural intellectual arrangement of the collection, end quote, as the finding aid specifies. It is organized into four series, which you'll see up by the arrow in the left-hand corner: theater, publications, activism, and the 2022 accretion. Series one, theater, contains four boxes of documents related to Rodríguez's theater practice between 1977 and 2011. And folders 1 through 10, which you see listed in the bottom right-hand corner of box two, contain material explicitly related to El Concilio de Amor. So to go to Oscar Panizza, who you see on screen, he originally published the script for Das Liebeskonsul, the play's original German title, in Zurich in 1895. The play is set in the spring of 1495, when the first recorded case of syphilis appeared in Europe. The satire takes place in heaven, hell, and the palace of Pope Alexander VI. And in the narrative, we see the corrupt Holy Family, which includes a decrepit God, an apathetic Jesus Christ, and a really vain Virgin Mary, recruit the devil to advise them on how to regain their popularity. The devil suggests that they create syphilis, a beautiful woman that he makes through intercourse with Salome. The Holy Family hopes that the horrors that syphilis inflicts on humans will terrify them back to religion. The play was immediately banned in Bavaria, and Panizza was put on trial in April 1895 before the Royal Court of Munich. He was ultimately imprisoned for a year and charged with 93 counts of blasphemy. The Council of Love was translated into Spanish by the editorial Icaria in 1977, and Rodriguez first read it in 1985. She and her performance troupe, Las Divas, were immediately fascinated. Rodriguez explains, quote, "It was not the plot or the religion that were so important to us, but rather the manner in which the play represented the problem of corruption in the church, in this case, the Catholic Church," end quote. Rodriguez's version of El Concilio de Amor premiered on December 15, 1987 at the Foro Shakespeare in Colonia Condesa here in Mexico City. On screen, I am showing you the front pages of the program and the press release, which are held in the Jesús Rodríguez papers. She conceived El Concilio de Amor as one of her pastorela cabarets, which she staged in December to ridicule the Catholic Christmas tradition of pastorelas. The production took the format of a cabaret, meaning that among other criteria, it had a few actors who played multiple parts. It was conceived for a smaller space and a smaller audience, and it incorporated music throughout the play. Rodriguez herself played the devil. Daniel Jimenez Cacho played Jesus Christ. Paloma Woldrick was the Virgin Mary, and Adriana Olivera was God, amongst other actors. And as I mentioned before, given the visibility of the AIDS crisis by 1987, the parallel with syphilis in Panizza's script was abundantly clear. Following its December 1987 to early 1988 run at the Foro Shakespeare, Rodriguez and Las Divas brought El Concilio de Amor to Montreal in May 1989, and then to Hamburg the following month, and you're seeing the programs on screen of those productions as well. Rodriguez returned to the play again in 1995 when she staged it at her performance space, La Capilla Theater in Coyoacán, and then in Paris later that year. There are materials in Box 2, Folders 1 to 10 of the Jesús Rodríguez papers that document the performance and the content of the play, especially of the productions of the Foro Shakespeare and at La Capilla. For example, there are these photographs which show Rodriguez as the devil at the Foro Shakespeare. Here you see her again. And here are photographs of the performance in Hamburg. And we have more images of Jesús as the devil in this ring of fire, and I'm still trying to determine exactly which production these photographs are from. There are also various versions of the script, which include Rodriguez's own handwritten notation for pronunciation and translations. And you'll see here that she has replaced Panizza's generic angels with the angels of Marilyn Monroe, Greta Garbo, and Gloria Swanson. And in various versions, these angels took on different pop culture figures. In folder 8, we can find one of the production's run of shows. And then there was also this clipping from January 18th, 1988, in which the newspaper El Universal published a favorable review of the play. Titled El Concilio de Amor o de la Simpatía por el Diablo, the article introduces Rodriguez and Las Divas, outlines the play's narrative, and concludes that the play sympathizes with the devil, which the critic likes. However, just 5 days after this review was published, the press's treatment of El Concilio de Amor would drastically change. Suddenly, it focused less on the content of the play and more on the controversy surrounding it. On January 23rd, 1988, two coalitions of extreme Catholic right-wing groups, the Comité Nacional Pro Vida, led by Jorge Serrano Limón, and the Unión Nacional Sinarquista, led by Victor Atilano Gómez, organized a demonstration at the Museo de Arte Moderno in Mexico City. Between 500 people and 1,000 people arrived to demand the closure of the Arte Alternativo section of the Salón Nacional de Artes Plásticas. The catalyst for the protest was an installation that opened in November 1987. Titled Real Templo, Templo Real, by Orlando de la Rosa, the proposal saw the space filled with various collages. There was one reproduction of Da Vinci's Last Supper with Christ's face substituted by that of Pedro Infante, and you see the black and white reproduction on the left. However, the image that received the most attention was the one that showed the Virgen de Guadalupe, whose face was replaced by Marilyn Monroe's. And you can see a small reproduction of that work on the right on the front cover of this tabloid. And so although the exhibition had been open for a month and a half, it came to the attention of ProVida and the UNS when the newspaper Excelsior published an article in January 1988 that condemned the show as blasphemous. Tabloids quickly picked up the story, and protesters argued that the work insulted both religious Mexicans and national symbols. The exhibition was closed, yet this event led ProVida and the other radical right-wing groups to also target Gustavo Monroy's exhibition, Autorretratos Religiosos y Otras Series, at the Auditorio Nacional in Mexico City, the student exhibition El Luto Humano at the Instituto de Artes Visuales in Puebla, and of course, El Concilio de Amor. As I have found, we can trace this rapidly developing moment through the documents in the Jesus Rodriguez papers. They give a detailed picture of how El Concilio de Amor became part of a larger discourse on artistic censorship and freedom of expression, especially in 1988. And here I think it's appropriate to reference the late renowned scholar Jean Franco, who summarized the reactions to El Concilio de Amor, writing, quote, Panizza's play proved to be as unpalatable in the 1980s as it was in the 1890s, end quote. Rodriguez herself explains that she began to save documents from this moment when she realized the social and political impact that the play was having. As she expressed to me in an interview, quote, I saved information for this work, thinking that it should be documented for future threats of censorship of any kind, end quote. In this sense, she did not save documents so that the production itself could be reconstructed, but rather so that its entire socio-political relevance in cases of artistic censorship could be reinforced. And now I would like to show you all some examples of these types of documents in the Jesus Rodriguez papers. Folder 2 holds the front page of the cultural section of Excelsior from Tuesday, January 26, 1988, just 3 days after the first protest at the Museo de Arte Moderno. The cover includes a four-point statement by Jorge Alberto Manrique, then director of the Museo de Arte Moderno. And in this article, he asserts that the quick closure of Rolando de la Rosa's exhibition was for the safety of the work, the museum, and the public, not, as he defends, as an act of censorship or concession to the protesters. And he's very adamant about that. Another article on the same page details Rodriguez and Las Divas' response to the threats launched at them by ProVida. And as the article explains, shortly after the January 23rd protest, members of ProVida actually broke into the Foro Shakespeare to vandalize El Concilio de Amor's stage and costumes. And so due to this event and other threats, Rodriguez requested high-level security from the government. Another article on February 5th in El País outlines the court case between Serrano Limón and Rodriguez. And relatedly, the Jesus Rodriguez papers holds the letters between Las Divas' legal counsel and the Secretary of Public Education, in which Las Divas requested security protection following threats from ProVida. Documents such as an opinion piece from January 28th, published in La Jornada, represent the public actions taken by Mexico's artistic community. And here, numerous members of the art world denounce the, quote, intimidating and repressive actions, end quote, of the protesters on January 3rd. If you look closely at this document, and I know it's very difficult from here, but you can find names such as Carlos Monsiváis, Graciela Iturbide, Elena Poniatowska, and Marta Lamas, among many other major figures and organizations. And so they all signed this document. The artistic community also rallied in the media sphere to denounce the forced resignation of Manrique from the Museo de Arte Moderno on February 25th. And you'll see on the left that the art critic Teresa del Conde submitted an opinion representing the Instituto de Investigaciones Estéticas, as did a group of artists from Jalapa, which included Mayra Landau. Additionally, the papers trace the formation of the Comité de Trabajadores de las Artes Visuales en Defensa de la Libertad de Expresión. On February 18th, the well-known journalist Patricia Vega wrote this open letter that you see on screen to Las Divas, explaining that she thinks the play should close because of threats from ProVida. However, she asks in this letter how the play can end in a way that does not legitimize and encourage further censorship. And so as a sort of solution, she proposes to create a committee for the freedom of artistic expression. I will add that this so-called solution was seen by some members of the artistic community as just another form of censorship. We also see on screen on February 27th, La Jornada published another opinion piece that denounced the manipulation of religion and announced a meeting on March 2nd to form this committee that Vega had suggested. In fact, the document includes, the papers include the founding documents of that committee, various drafts that you're seeing on screen, one from February 27th, another from March 21st. And it also includes the announcement for the Festival Artístico por la Libertad de Expresión in the Plaza de Santo Domingo. And at that festival, Elena Poniatowska denounced intolerance and censorship, and the text of her speech at that festival was published one day later in La Jornada, and again, we find this in the papers. Rodriguez also saved many documents from the conservative right-wing groups who threatened and protested her. This document by the Comité Organizador de Instituciones Católicas announces a Misa de Desagravio, or a Mass for Reparations, on March 5th to ask for, as the text says, quote, forgiveness for the jokes and blasphemy that the pseudo-artistic work, El Concilio de Amor, is making in the face of the Holy Trinity and its sacred values, end quote. Rodriguez even found and saved documents that reference earlier productions of El Concilio de Amor that face censorship. This interview with the Spanish director Pere Planella is from 1980, so about 7 years before Rodriguez's production, when the Catalonian government canceled his production of El Concilio de Amor at the Teatro Lura in Barcelona. So to conclude, given the ephemeral nature of the performance and the fact that Rodriguez's cabarets often morphed and changed, even on a nightly basis, it is impossible to reconstruct in detail the production of the play from the documents and the papers. There is something ungraspable about it that one must accept. Nevertheless, what we do take away from the papers are the series of political events that unfolded around and in response to the play. And so this brings me back to my argument that this archive expands our understanding of what it means to reconstruct a performance through documentation. In addition to Diana Taylor, who has been cited by a number of our colleagues over the past 2 days, there are a number of performance scholars and art historians who address the complex relationship between material remains and live performance. We have Amelia Jones, who argues that the specificity of experiencing the live performance should not be privileged over the knowledge that develops from encountering a performance through documentation. And then we also have important figures like Philip Auslander, who sees what Taylor calls the repertoire as available in both the live performance and in the archival recording. And then Rebecca Schneider is someone else who interrogates the why and how performance practice has routinely been disavowed as historical practice. And so despite these significant contributions, these scholars focus on the question of performance in relation to the archive when the archive is used to historicize or reconstruct the content of the performance. But I want to articulate an idea that is quite different. That yes, the papers show the performance archive can be something that attempts to reconstruct the live performance, but also that expands the political scope of the performance by altering its interpretive framework. So in this sense, I also wonder if and how we can define the limits of performance when it spills and seeps out of the quote-unquote live moment. Relatedly, in this case, I would suggest that the mission of the archival institution supports this interpretation. As previously mentioned, the Tamment Library and Wagner Labor Archives are dedicated to histories of left politics and labor history, which differs from an archival institution dedicated specifically to art or performance. Therefore, this collecting area furthers the idea that the Jesús Rodríguez papers, and specifically the documents on El Concilio de Amor, can be seen through the lens of radical politics. In an interview with Jean Franco, Rodriguez elaborates on the meaning that El Concilio de Amor developed amidst the 1988 controversy. She references the Devil's Monologue in Act 3, Scene 2. When speaking about what he will ask of God in return for creating syphilis, the devil decides he will request to freely print and circulate his books because, as he says, quote, to think and not to be able to express our thoughts is the worst form of torture, end quote. Rodriguez explains that, quote, to say this on stage when the problem was being discussed in the newspapers gave the work a much greater power than when it was staged before the threat, end quote. In this sense, the articles published in the media, the protest flyers, the legal documents requesting protection, these quote unquote archival documents all become part of the work as well as documents of it. They allow an audience to imagine what the work was like because the work became inseparable from the case of artistic censorship developing throughout Mexico. The archive, therefore, is part of the performance. And I'm wrapping up, but I would like to take this argument one step further. I would propose that Rodriguez chose to interpret Panizza's El Concilio de Amor, not just to reconstruct the play's content. Rather, she did so because of the archival documents that expand our understanding of the 1895 political context. She has said on more than one occasion that Panizza's self-defense in court was inspirational to her. The transcription of Panizza's self-defense is so tied to the play that it is printed at the end of many editions of The Council of Love, including the one I used in my research for this presentation. At the end of his 1895 defense, Panizza cites evidence of spreading religious skepticism in order to ask the jury, do you believe that today the times are such as to permit more rigorous censorship? Therefore, continuing with my argument, I propose that Rodriguez's interpretation of Panizza's play was not solely based on the script, scenography, etc., but also on the political moment that encapsulated its original release in the 19th century. Just as a quick coda to my talk, I would like to bring this topic into the present by asking what the Jesus Rodriguez papers can tell us about recent cases of censorship. Just as one example, we could think about the exhibition Emiliano Zapata Después de Zapata at the Palacio de Bellas Artes from 2019 to 2020. This exhibition saw attempts to censor and violent reactions to the painting La Revolución by Fabián Chaires. Many of you here today are familiar with events, and for those of you who aren't, details are widely available, so I will not recount them. However, I reference this case because it demonstrates that over 30 years since the events surrounding El Concilio de Amor, freedom of artistic expression in Mexico and abroad still face threats of censorship from the right and the left, especially when it comes to interpretations of the country's national heroes, be they religious or revolutionary. Here, Taylor's proposal that, quote, history, like performance, is never for the first time, but it too is actualized in the present, end quote, seems to be all too true, especially in cases of artistic censorship. In thinking about the connections and disjunctures between 1988 and 2019, I was particularly intrigued by a quote by the exhibition's curator, Luis Vargas, who is here with us during this conference. Talking to the digital art forum, Hyperallergic, he stated, quote, they wanted to censor the painting. Instead, they've ensured that it will be inscribed into history, end quote. This idea gets at the very heart of how we need to reconsider the archive of art, be it performance or painting, as more than the materials that we can use to reconstruct them, but that reformulate them over time in relationship to the events and the reactions that they provoke. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Madeline. And now I would like to welcome up our next presenter. Joseph Shakowitz is a PhD student at New York University's Institute of Fine Arts. Their research focuses on Latin American modernisms and the intersections of feminist, queer, and trans practices and histories. Today, Joseph will present Image, Incoherency, and João Francisco dos Santos, Madame Sata. Give us just a moment while we're shifting presentations.
Hello, everyone. That was a short bio, so thanks for bearing with us. I wanted to thank the team very much at ALA for organizing this year's conference and for this opportunity to present my work, and also to thank everyone for joining. I really look forward to our discussion to follow. Sequins are a time-consuming material with which to work. Each tiny, lustrous disc does little on its own, but when joined to a cacophonous composite, a shimmering kinesis, it sparkles almost blindingly. Sequins create animacy atop animacy. When illuminated, they heighten, almost to a point of excess, the body in motion, kicks, sways, swings. There are hundreds of angles producing hundreds of reflections that evade and overwhelm the gaze, a kaleidoscopic confusion. But sequins, too, are expensive. João Francisco de Santos faced this very predicament when preparing for a fantasy costume contest during Carnival in Rio de Janeiro in 1938. His friends, the Circle of Queer Bohemians, of which he was a part, persuaded him to enter, seeing it as a natural extension of the gender-bending cabaret acts he had performed since the late 1920s. "I could only afford to put sequins on the horns and the mask," he writes, "and I thought it was a shame because the ideal thing was that the entire costume was covered with sequins. I made the body of my costume with those golden ribbons used for coffins. At first, I hesitated, but then I figured no one would imagine that I was wearing coffin ribbons at Carnival. When the costume was ready and I put it on, I didn't even recognize the golden ribbons, and I thought I could be very successful in the parade, even a frenzy, lux. De Santis makes do, that is, he adapts his carnival fantasy, a sparkling sequin-clad full-body ensemble, and locates a feasible alternative in the cheap, satiny sheen of the ribbons, an insignia marking death, now taking on new life. He would go on to win first place in the contest, an event that can only partially be explained by his makeshift wardrobe. I think my performance was as important as my extremely original costume. Following De Santis' words, we begin to understand that it's his staging of a theatricalized self, achieved through the use of image and masquerade, that contributed to his crowd-pleasing procession. In spite of De Santis' popularity and national lore, scholars have yet to consider the performative practice of this Afro-Brazilian cabaret artist, sex worker, rogue, and outlaw. Among the already sparse literature on De Santis, the majority focuses on the ways his homosexuality confounded his everyday image as a virile streetwise hustler, producing a seemingly irreconcilable hybridity. The fact that he engaged in street fights, brawled with police, murdered rivals, and was a skilled martial artist further departed from the associations between queerness and effeminate passivity that dominated Brazil in the early 20th century. Yet De Santis also invoked and dramatized this contradictory corporeality through a number of feminine, racially fluid alter egos that he first developed within Rio's cabaret scene. His practice, as writes scholar Malik Gaines of Blackness, operated, quote, "a theater across the border from modernity's privileged territory, drawing attention to the ways Blackness is tied to the bodies that are bound to appear on its platform and the ways those bodies are gendered," end quote. More than a mere paradox, that is the gay fugitive, De Santis deployed theater, drag, and camp to actively negotiate and reimagine his image alongside the racial, gendered, national, and punitive logics that circumscribed it. This presentation resituates De Santis within the social and cultural history of Brazil during its Second Republic. Setting aside his mythification and symbolic appropriation since the 1970s, I emphasize the relationship between De Santis' performative personas and the expanded significance of Blackness, queerness, drag, and other criminalized embodiments in early 20th century Rio. In so doing, I argue that De Santis staged a mutable, incoherent self-image, when they confused legible signifiers of identity as they existed within a modern national imaginary and deployed it as a means of agitation and escape, at times figurative, and as we'll come to see, literal as well. This project nevertheless begins from a place of indeterminacy. That is, it intimates an account of a figure whose visual presence in the archives in relation to the time period under consideration remains unknown should it exist in the first place. And this is why I'll rely on many blank slides. How then does one produce an art history devoid of a visual referent? Does this representational absence simply affirm the oppressive taxonomies of the archive, or might it point us elsewhere toward an understanding of De Santis's refusal of a static, reproducible image? Like the sequined surfaces I evoked in the introduction, did De Santis construct a personage so scintillating and discordant so as to become unintelligible, hard to see? Following the invitation of scholars like Diana Taylor and Cydia Hartman to traffic in this zone of the known, the unknown, and that affective space hovering between them, this research turns to the unchronicled, gestures, silences, omissions, to chart a wayward history of queer world making. In reapproaching De Santis, I rely upon interviews, court documents, an uncommon group of comparative imagery, and a fanciful autobiography to speculate about his performative practice and contextualize it within the cultural history of the 1920s through 1940s. This lattermost biographical piece, published in 1972, and in which De Santis narrates his life story to a Brazilian telenovela writer, peddles what this scholar Gima Rocha has characterized as De Santis's mito historia, or myth history. The document poses additional challenges given its appearance in the final decade of De Santis's life, a period in which he emphasized his legacy of trickery and outlaw status, leaving fewer narrative clues as to his performative practice. However, the traces he recounts, feelings, ambitions, pseudonyms, venues, attire, offer a point of departure, apocryphal or otherwise, to piece together an unruly chapter in the history of modern Brazil. Tiradentes Square. Toward the end of the 1920s, De Santis began performing at the Casa de Sape in downtown Rio. He lived nearby in the Bohemian neighborhood of Lapa, cycling between boarding houses, bordellos, tenement stoops, and park benches. As a child runaway, De Santis had grown up in and around the city's brothels, where he encountered their hazy underworld of sexual fantasy, a place where locals and newcomers, racial difference, and erotic desires mingled and converged. By his teenage years, while working as a waiter at a house of tolerance in Lapa, he met the up-and-coming Portuguese actor Sara Nobre, who introduced him to those working in show production, leading to his first role in a small cabaret performance in town. Around 1928, following his theatrical debut, De Santis developed the cross-dressed stage persona of a femme samba dancer he named Mulata do Balacoche, which I translate imperfectly as swinging mulata. He took to the stage with his long hair twisted into braids and a flowy red skirt, the sultry beat of a brejeiro samba filling the dark room. The tipsy bohemian audience crowded the small venue, and as its bright stage lights illuminated Mulata do Balacoche's swaying hips and fluid movements, they also animated the farce beneath the surface of his performance. With the deep blackness of his skin, De Santis represented not the mixed race Afro-Portuguese mulata his moniker claimed, but an exaggerated staging of the racialized and tropicalized fantasy with which it was associated in national culture. A descendant of those born into slavery in Brazil, De Santis witnessed the cultural value placed on the whitening process of miscegenation, an appeasing fiction of a likeness designed to overshadow and invisibilize the country's black, indigenous, and Asian populations. Thus, by himself becoming the female mulata, De Santis performed a warped erotics of national myth, layering a fantasy of interraciality and self-erasure atop his patently black body. His cross-dress appearance further subverted the politicized utopia of a homogeneously raced Brazil. The combination of DeSantis's open homosexuality and assumption of feminine dress removed him from the heterosexual, procreative discourse of national whitening. It is not, however, solely DeSantis's queer self-identification that tarnishes this national cum-racial project. As the historian James Green notes, homosexuality in Brazil, as elsewhere in the early 20th century, was constructed through two ostensibly opposed camps, that of the homem, or real man, and the bicha, or the faggot, or maricón. The former, associated with the active sexual position, retained an unchallenged masculinity and oftentimes heterosexuality, whereas the latter, as the passive partner and thus closer in proximity to womanhood, was socially stigmatized and reviled. Throughout his adult life, DeSantis unabashedly embraced his sexual preference in this so-called passive role, and through his feminine masquerade as Mulata do Balacoche, magnified the extent to which his body disobeyed the progenitive paradigm underlying nation-building and whitened citizenship. Nevertheless, actual Afro-Portuguese women in modern Rio operated in the crosshairs of fetishistic desire, most literally among male clientele seeking sexual rendezvous at brothels such as those in which DeSantis worked and lived. This eroticization of the mulata owes, in Alison Fronhar's view, to a prevailing dynamic by which, quote, the mulata was European enough to be visible and beautiful to the white male subject, and African enough to be typologized as sexual, primitive, desirable, and available, end quote. DeSantis's addendum of Mulata do Balacoche, the swinging mulata, hyperbolizes this sexualization and objectification. His movements, equal parts rhythmic, erogenous, and satirical, opened a world of multiplied meanings. Thus, a cross-dressed, dark-skinned, samba-dancing, lip-syncing, hip-swaying, rear-shaking spectacle coalesces into a projection of colonial modernity's fantasies of whiteness and of nation. Through minor plays on his own identity, his blackness becoming mulata, his queer affinities morphing into travestiness, DeSantis heightened the potential for his body to perform and absorb abject yet also eroticized difference. From his performance as Mulata do Balacoche came a suite of successive alter egos in which DeSantis troubled through enactment and mimicry, the ostensibly well-oiled machine of the Brazilian body politic. The most prominent of his personages arose, at least initially, from a misrecognition. Upon concocting his sequin and ribbon-covered costume for the 1938 carnival competition with which I opened, DeSantis found his inspiration in a bat, common to the state of Pernambuco in which he spent his earliest years. I remembered from my childhood that I had known a bat whose name was the Pampa Bat, because he sucked the blood of the cattle on the farm. I thought that besides being original, it could be very divine. With sequined horns and bewitching pageantry, DeSantis assumed the stage as a glittery, blood-hungry creature of the night, taking home first prize. However, weeks later at the Paseo Público, a downtown spot known as a site for cruising, DeSantis, along with a group of other queer men, was apprehended by police. As one curious patrolman took down their information, eager to know especially the names of their drag personas, he grew frustrated when DeSantis refused to offer up an alias. Suddenly, the policeman questioned, quote, "Weren't you the one who dressed up as Madame Isata and won the faggot parade at República this year?" End quote. Although DeSantis insisted that he had dressed as a bat, the nickname Madame Isata quickly stuck and spread throughout the city. The officer mistook DeSantis' costume as the winged creature with that of another, the titular protagonist of U.S. director Cecil B. DeMille's 1930 musical comedy, Madame Satan. The movie, which had been screening that year in Rio, starred Kay Johnson as Angela, a wealthy socialite who attempts to win back her husband's affections by disguising herself at a masquerade gathering as a fiery, mysterious temptress. In her concealing vamp attire, Madame Satan personifies the enchanting femme fatale, harnessing her femininity for personal gains. While DeSantis rejected this association at first, he muses, "I gradually came to terms with it." And later, comparing my nickname with the nicknames of others, I saw that mine was much prettier and more memorable. With this identification as Malamistata, an alias that has in many instances eclipsed a knowledge of the performer's given name, DeSantis redeployed and distorted the image of Hollywood glamour, demure, and feminine ease that emerged as a cultural export of the US's cinematic golden age. Whereas in the then popular film, a clip from which we see here, Johnson's character personified the concomitant mobility of whiteness and wealth, DeSantis, by becoming a fixed instantiation of this devilish alter ego, inverted the lexicon of Hollywood celebrity. His queer, black, masculine, poor, overtly sexual body cheapened as it wielded Johnson's portrayal as Madame Satan. The gradual equation of DeSantis with Marmisata also intervened into the very logic of policing and national order that gave rise to his sobriquet. The interruption of his nighttime saunter along the Paseo Público and his subsequent christening as Marmisata reflect those state apparatuses designed to surveil the presence of gender and sexual otherness within public life. And I think it's worth noting that the officer's recognition of DeSantis stems from the pleasure he himself derived from his own attendance at the travesty fantasy costume contest, attesting in a way to the transient cultural permissibility of gender variant performances within the set temporal confines of carnival. In the case of DeSantis, his visual signifiers of difference were often conflated with perceptions of his criminal deviance. In one court case from 1946, the prosecution argued, quote, "He is a passive pederast. He shaves his eyebrows and adopts feminine ways, even altering his own voice. Nevertheless, he is an extremely dangerous person since he doesn't even respect police authorities," end quote. The non-expressly masculine traits with which he presented here correspond to DeSantis's illicit queer sexuality, but also to an impossibly perilous composite, that of a bisha capable of trickery and violence. DeSantis lived the majority of his adult life in prisons. His run-ins with Brazilian police were frequent and in notable cases fatal. Thus, his assumption of the patrol officer's mockery, which equated DeSantis' glamorous tribute to a hometown bat to a ridiculous and inadequate parody of Madame Satan's namesake seductress, co-opted those apparatus of power that name and pathologize social dissidents. By the end of 1942, DeSantis' performance in the carceral framework converged once again. As one police record tells us, quote, "Following an order issued by the cabinet of the chief of police, the invert was taken to the Ilha Grande Correctional Colony. During the journey, Malamisata demonstrated his art by imitating Carmen Miranda, managing to capture the attention of the guards with the swaying of his hips, and thereby help the other prisoners to escape," end quote. Within this bureaucratic invocation of his popular impersonation of Carmen Miranda, the white Portuguese-born entertainer who garnered fame for her racially sanitized and insistently tropicalized caricature of black femininity, we glimpse many hallmarks of DeSantis's performative practice. Riffs on race, gender, stardom, and desire, animated through character, voice, movement, and dance, that unforgettably disruptive swaying of his hips. In this anecdote, he confuses the language of the body and those identities projected upon it long enough for his fellow detainees to abscond from custody, an incomprehensible act that undercuts mechanisms of state violence and control. Across his many performances, DeSantis deliberately rehearsed an image, mutable and multiple, that disoriented concepts of race, gender, sexuality, and nation, creating corporeal paradoxes, exaggerations, and contestations. That theatricalized self once brought about an actual moment of escape, but also embodied a means of refusal and excess subjecthood that pushed at the boundaries of intelligibility. In this chameleonic form, DeSantis relayed an imagination of the self otherwise, a visual cacophony at the edge of determinacy. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Joseph. Our next presenter. Our next presenter is Cecilia Gonzalez Golino. She is a PhD candidate at the University of Pennsylvania, whose research is focused on the analysis of Caribbean contemporary visual art from archipelagic, non-hegemonical frameworks. Her work engages with epidermic and geological aesthetics as strategies of disorientation and resistance against colonial attempts to the figuration of Caribbean identities. Her first exhibition as main curator, Unsovereign Elements, Geological Poetics in Contemporary Art from the Caribbean and its Diaspora, will be on view from March 30th to May 10th at the Brodsky Gallery in Philadelphia. Today, Cecilia's presentation is entitled Notebook of No Return to the Native Land, Geological Archives of Indenture in Kelly Sinapa Mary. Just one moment. Bueno, mientras que esperar para el Zoom, cosas así, quiero invitar a la gente que están mirando en vivo para preguntar cualquier cosa en inglés, en English o en español. Todas las presentaciones en este panel están en inglés, pero podemos discutir después en español. Casi empezamos ya.
Thank you. Hi, hello. Hola, hola a todos. Thank you first for all your patience. I'm going to be presenting in English, so I might as well change now and put my mind in English as well. Before I start, I wanted to say thank you to the ALAA team for putting together this amazing conference. I am really happy to be here, and I wanted to extend special thanks to Leslie for organizing our panel. So thank you all. And thank you for your patience again. Caribbean cultural products and critical approaches are highly permeated by submarine, geological, and atmospheric aesthetics, too often enclosed within frameworks of unavoidable catastrophe, prolonged crisis, or fetishized tropicalism that posit nature as either a destructive or a picturesque force. Starting with colonization, early merchant economy, and capitalist expansion in the Americas, geological elements were relegated, and still seem to be, to a fossilized backdrop status, defined and configured by modernity as epistemological vacuums, decorative backdrops or disaster vectors whose sole purpose was to be traversed, extracted from, and commodified. However, oceans, jungles, hurricanes, currents, and other natural phenomena are inapprehensible totalities that extend far beyond their materiality and beyond binary formulations of human nature relations. They can never be contained within borders or even within national narratives, yet they do participate in the archipelagic production of identity, and they inform and inhabit the periphery of narratives of independence, statehood, and colony. These dynamics contributed to the colonial image of the Caribbean archipelago as a linguistically geopolitically fragmented entity, despite its geological archipelagic unity. Archipelagos naturally resist colonial attempts of apprehension, comprehension, and figuration. Where does an archipelago begin and end? Although these ideas articulate a much extensive project and an exhibition, today I will talk about an ongoing project by Guadeloupe-based Indo-Caribbean artist Kelly Sinapamiri, titled Notebook of No Return to the Native Land. And I will focus on how this project allows us to rethink the complex linkages between history, dispossession, race, nature, and place within the context of indentureship. In this sense, I move away from conceptualizations of Caribbean nature as a historical, economic, and picturesque background that too often depict Caribbean bodies of nature and of flesh in scenes of labor, or more recently, and within the visitor's economy that drives the region, sexualized in natural backgrounds, as is the case of postcards. I turn instead to propose archipelagic nature as an unsovereign geological archive, understanding the world geological as the logic emerging from constitutive relationships between landscape, identity, and history in the Caribbean. Quoting Edouard Glissant, history is spread out beneath its surface, from the mountains to the sea, from north to south, from the forest to the beaches. Our landscape is its own monument. Its meaning can only be traced on the underside. It is all history, end of quote. Undoubtedly, geological elements are a fact of continuity in the region, not only as products of the violent processes of extraction, but as archives of exploitation that bear witness to the violence exerted on colonized bodies. To illustrate, the background plant in this and other paintings from the series is the Sansevieria trifasciata, also known as mother-in-law's tongue or snake plant. Native to West Africa, the plant is now ubiquitous worldwide, a paradigmatic example of a continuity between the transplantation of bodies and of plants as a result of colonization. I even have one at home, so I know this firsthand. This also illustrates not only the physical but the conceptual opacity of the Caribbean environment and its historical relationship to the bodies that inhabit and labor it. One could even say that the background of indenture, the environment in which Indo-Caribbeans came to exist, was already made by West African bodies and cannot exist outside of it. So my claim is that geological elements share what Glisson formulated as the colonized right to opacity and to obscurity, namely the right not to be legible under colonial lenses, the right not to be completely captured by these colonial lenses. The demand of opacity is hereby extended to all bodies systematically dispossessed of their agency by colonial dynamics, including human and non-human bodies. So the questions remaining, and that I will hopefully answer through Sinapa Mary's work, are: what happens when the seminal human-land relationship is dislocated by dispossession and forced transplantation? How are these underside continuities between colonized bodies of flesh, of nature, and of knowledge, staged in both colonial and non-colonial representations of Caribbean identity and memory? To begin with, the artist raises the question of belonging, of roots, and the relationship to place by referencing and resignifying the foundational epic poem of Negritude by Martinican thinker and politician Aimé Césaire, Cahier d'un retour au pays natal, or Notebook of a Return to the Native Land. In his poem, Aimé Césaire presents himself as alienated both from the island and from his continental African roots. He reflects on returning to Africa as his native land to find a way towards self-identification. By invoking his ancestry, he summons the power to return to his homeland, triumphant, rooted, and full of promise. Meanwhile, Sinapa Mary embraces this sense of alienation and integrates her uprootedness into her identity and the identity of the Caribbean subject. For her, there is no return to the native land, because in no land converge all the entanglements of colonization, transplantation, and dependency. The impossibility of a homeland drives the project, which also explores its consequences: an Indo-Caribbean insistence on making India the lost homeland, and a subsequent persistence of essentializing ethnic identity politics, or the drive to make France the promised homeland and to assimilate to European organizations of knowledge, materializing Sinapa Mary's recourse to fairy tales. We can see here, actually, that this is Cinderella, and it is in scenes like of self-mutilation. So this happens continuously throughout her project. Yeah, I'm sorry. But Sinapa Mary's conclusion is that there is an insurmountable fracture, a cut both from her ancestors' culture and the colonial culture, materialized in her artworks as scenes of self-mutilation. In the artist's words, becoming aware of my story and my misunderstanding about my identity made me feel uncomfortable. It was as if I had awakened one day from my limbs. I was missing pieces of me. As noted by the artist, she was born in Guadeloupe to an Indo-Caribbean family, her ancestors having moved from India to Guadeloupe in the 19th century, following an agreement by the French government that sought to replenish the French colony with laborers after slavery had been abolished. Many families that crossed the ocean at the time believed they would only be there for a predetermined contracted period, but very few had the conditions to return to their countries and ultimately came to set up a new diasporic chapter in the Caribbean islands. That said, the colonized sense of belonging necessarily responds to a different relationship with the environment, because it cannot rely on westerly legitimized senses of genealogical, territorial, national, or proprietary heritage. The social contract is other. It is always dependent and always diasporic. The Caribbean region the Caribbean experiment was inaugurated by a prolonged act of genocide that emptied the region from its inhabitants, making it urgent for the early merchant economy to bring more bodies, to bring more labor. And this need quickly translated into indigenous forced labor, the Middle Passage and slavery, and later into indentured servitude, a form of debt bondage where individuals worked to repay a debt, usually the journey to the colonies from southern Asia. Although theoretically different and articulated through different legal and social contracts, these forms of organization of labor were cut from the same cloth. This clarification is crucial when talking about the geological because the relationship between the colonized bodies and the colonized landscape is always already mediated by labor. It does not exist outside of the incipient capitalism that required it. According to Barbadian thinker George Lamming, and I quote, "It is through work that men and women make nature a part of their own history. And the way we see, the way we hear, the sense of touch and smell, the whole complex of feeling we call sensibility, is influenced by the particular features of the landscape, which has been humanized by our work," end of quote. And for many indentured workers, the physical act of traversing the sea generated a depth, creating a bond between colonized bodies of water and bodies of flesh that is different from Middle Passage slavery. Kelly Sinapameri's work explicitly establishes an ecocritical continuity between these bodies and revisits the space, the times, and the forms in which this relationship resurfaced throughout the centuries. As theorized by Monique Allouard, and I quote, "Colonial organizations of labor power, particularly the plantation form, required the slaves or indentured workers become deeply familiar with the properties of non-human animal and plant life, as well as with climatological and atmospheric phenomena," end of quote. Likewise, Western notions of sovereignty of the nation, but also of the self, presuppose the existence of bounded bodies of matter and the epistemological encapsulation of human and non-human entities into essentialist narratives. Containment is a distinctive colonial strategy of control that aligns with many conceptualizations of sovereignty. That said, Caribbean identity cannot exist outside its inherent tension with the physically enclosed spaces of modernity. The master's house, the plantation, even the island, or outside conceptual and sovereign enclosures of identity, such as citizenship, race, or ethnicity. These and many others are the enclosures that Notebook of No Return resists, but not only collapsing different temporalities, but also by collapsing spaces that are usually separated in humanistic accounts of history and whose forced alterity serves as the foundation of the Caribbean visual economy, the domestic, the public, the natural, and the aesthetic. This triptych's choice materializes this violence of enclosure and of containment, while the link between its three parts reveals a continuity under the surface. Containment is hardly a stable strategy, and although slaved and indentured communities were not designed for social living, another domestic and social space, developed in these islands. And actually, that is actually the house that I was referencing. Actually, from the very first encounter with her art, one is presented with the tension between the domestic space and the processes of domestication exerted by the imperial powers in the Caribbean. Visual technologies of knowledge, such as cartography, portraiture, or photography, among many others, served to effectively maintain, reinvent, and reinforce a sense of superficial epistemological cohesion. Once natural phenomena were inspected and mapped, translated to modern registers and adapted to modern imperatives, they became available for knowledge or domesticated. For the word, Merriam-Webster suggests a definition for domesticated, adapted over time from a wild or natural state to life in close association with and to the benefit of humans, end of quote. But which humans are those? How are the domestic space and the process of domestication related? What is home in such an oppressive process of uprooting, of rerooting? What is the native land when belonging is interrupted by transplantation? These questions, materialized in the artist's pieces, force us to reconsider the scope of Caribbean archives and the relationship between the archive and the land. What happens when bodies are diasporic and memory is not necessarily bounded to one place? To think of Caribbean memory as geological, as not dependent on linear time-space and always exceeding its own materiality, allows us to deconstruct the archival anxiety to locate bodies and identities somewhere in time and space. Likewise, it carries the impossibility for this geological archive to be accessed through singular, sequential, or superficial accounts. And the same happens in Sinapa's multimodal exhibitions. The viewer can decide to stay a long-distance viewer or to navigate the experiential environment. The seminal essay by Martinican thinker Suzanne Césaire, The Great Camouflage, opens with an act of seeing, more specifically, an act of seeing a layered geomorphic mass from a long distance of contemplating it, echoing the first sighting of land by Spanish conquistadors, a paradigmatic model of the genesis of the scopic regimes of coloniality that juxtaposed seeing, knowing, and possessing. By embodying a master contemplating the land he believed sounded expensive, end of quote, Césaire reenacts the Western fiction of accessing the real through panoramic views and the making of meaning through long distance observation. Meanwhile, Kelly's In Apa Meris multimodal installations, which include different objects and materials, reject long distance observation, panoramic, and even photographic views of the Caribbean experience. Instead, she forces the eye to go beyond surface readings and towards more sensorial experiences of memory. Here, memory is relational, rhizomatic, and cannot be apprehended by colonial notions of genealogical heritage, echoing Deleuze and Guattari's raison model. Her project explicitly stages scenes of figurative colonization, emulating pinturas de casta, portraits, even postcards. But while these visual technologies of knowledge showed images of controlled nature and of controlled bodies, the artist disrupts these violent figurations by erasing the ontological boundaries between human and non-human matter. Moreover, this movement negates the conceptualization of the geological as a historical background and brings nature to the front of the identification process. Oh, sorry. Similarly, she drastically erases the physical and conceptual horizon line from her pieces, wisely identified by scholar Andrea Davies as a fiction of modernity. The horizon has been aligned with ideas of development, of progress, and of idealistic futures that too often favored Western imperialistic projects in the Americas. This fiction of the horizon is especially relevant within the indenture enterprise, where the promise of a better future was literally equaled to the sea horizon, to migrating by boat to the Americas, mostly from India, to work in the plantation system after slavery was abolished. Indentureship was promoted as different from slavery, but ended up being yet another reconfiguration of the Middle Passage. The fiction of the horizon, once again, staged a horizon of possibilities that extends itself indefinitely for other non-white ways of being and inhabiting the world. That said, Notebook of No Return is not only negating the fiction of a return, in this case to India as the native land or Africa, but also the fiction of the promised land. Past and future are collapsed into a prolonged present, as we can see here in the creature, like the many legs. Lacking any referential element, these pieces back here are not framed by colonial temporalities and exist outside linear accounts of history that too often approach the Caribbean region as a linear and failed project towards sovereignty. Thinking with and through Yarimar Bonilla, I consider sovereignty the paradigm and flagship of modernity insofar that it reproduces colonial taxonomies and their exclusionary genealogies hidden behind universally shared fictions of humanity, independence, citizenship, and nationality. These linger in the idea that sovereignty is achievable by anyone and anything at some point, when the sole idea of sovereignty implies figuration and categorization within a national or otherwise singular framework, and the inscription in its politics of representation and visibility. That is why I argue that these unsovereign elements, unsovereign archives, and I establish the notion of unsovereignty and the unsovereign as an open category for everybody of flesh, of nature, and of knowledge, whose power resides not in its figurative agency or the power to organize meaning into categories, but in its ecological and relational agency, as meaning makers themselves. Drawing from Yarimar Bonilla's formulations on non-sovereignty, geological elements act as unsovereign historical entities insofar they are non-codifying and non-figurative entities that function as both producers, products, and evaders of colonial logics. As a final example, I want to shed light on some textile pieces included in this project that instead of embodying the trope of camouflage to exist beyond colonial enclosures, they subvert the directionality of representation by dislocating Western visual imperatives. To illustrate, this is Theodore de Bry's map of the West Indies from 1594, which is considered one of the earliest and more complete mappings of the Circum Caribbean. And it is a paradigmatic example of the application of Western figurative conventions to produce an image more familiar to the European eye, And it configures islandness not only as remoteness, but also as blackness. So here, really briefly, we can see that some islands are either empty, which signals to the lack of resources, or their continuation of continental figurative conventions. We also detect an identical pattern to map the space of the sea, and a series of sea monsters or sea cows that I suggest are a strategy to locate and deflect the anxieties of the unknown. So in this tapestry, the pattern mapping the sea is juxtaposed to a geological display of undersurface matter, signaling to the opacity of the sea and rejecting its conceptualization as solely a medium towards a goal. We can also identify the imposition of visual imperatives from Europe's figurative tradition onto the space of the island as a continuation of patterned scenes of discovery and tiding. Yet in this case, a severed head, interrupts this pattern, bringing to the surface the foundational violence and foundational genocides of such spaces. Even the decorative ribbons suggest that the colonial enterprise was sustained by a figurative, even decorative, effort in its attempt to maintain stable, homogeneous, and geometrical images of empire. So to conclude, Kelly Sinapa Murray's work is an example of how contemporary artists from the Caribbean and its diaspora resist modern and colonial attempts to appropriate the natural and limit its power to its extractive potential, from the premise that there exists a constitutive geological relationship between the bodies of flesh and the bodies of nature. This relationship, although unavoidably mediated by labor and commodification, retains a poetic potential that moves away from tropicalist and deterministic approaches and signals to an ecological agency found in the coexistence and not the apprehension of the natural. To decolonize and to deconstruct the way in which this relationship is contextualized and to revalorize its poetic potential not only integrates nature as a constituent part of history, but allows for geological, non-anthropocentric, and non-linear archival and historical practices. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cecilia. And so now I welcome our final presenter for this panel. And I want to note how much I've been struck by this idea of self-identification in the archives that seems to have emerged in this panel. And so to welcome our final panelist, we'll be hearing from Benjamin Murphy, who is currently the A.W. Mellon Postdoctoral Fellow at the Center for Advanced Study in the Visual Arts at the National Gallery of Art in Washington. Previously, he worked as a visiting assistant professor in the Department of the History of Art and Architecture at the University of Oregon. Benjamin received his PhD in art history from Princeton University, where his doctoral research was supported by a Fulbright Fellowship and by a Donald and Mary Hyde Fellowship. Today, Benjamin will present Not a Trace, Learning from Video's Paradoxical Archive. And I'll take this opportunity to note for everyone who's in the audience, I know it might be a little bit challenging to read some of the captions or to see some of the details in the images. You are encouraged and welcome to take a look at the recordings on the Estéticas YouTube website, where the recordings will be. There's really beautiful resolution on there.
Hey, hello everyone. Before I start, just to reiterate the thank yous everyone else has said, I'm so thrilled to be here. I'm very grateful to Ala and to Estéticas and to Franz Meyer for hosting us today. So I will get started. I begin with two documents. Pictures of unidentified crowds framed within television monitors. These cognate images figure as prime objects from the early history of video art in Latin America. On the left, a press release announces a 1974 presentation by the Buenos Aires-based Centro de Arte y Comunicación, or CAIC, of several videos at New York's Museum of Modern Art, an event that would mark the beginning of the Argentine art space's intensive engagement with the technology throughout the 70s. With its facility for recording and its capacity for instant screening at a distance, video, according to the Centro's founder and director, Jorge Glusberg, offered the means to build alternative broadcast networks that could run counter to those which structured global commercial media. Glusberg positioned the CAIC as a forum for constructing precisely such alternative networks. And the document on the right offers a unique and little-known object to emerge from this forum. Produced in 1977 by the Colombian artist Conier Marin, who was an active participant in the Centro's video art programming. Oh, are we good? Okay. You can all hear me now? Okay. So produced in 1977 by the Colombian artist Conier Marin, who was an active participant in the Centro's video art programming, the image on the right comprises part of a larger project in which the artist mailed photographic documentation of videos he had produced to artist colleagues in various neighboring countries, thus effectively constructing a new video-based network of his own. The two documents convey the political ethos that both Glusberg and Marin associated with such networks. Their images of jostling crowds proffering vague yet suggestive pictures of the types of resistance they imagined arising from an alternative use of televisual technology. Yet these two documents also instance a central paradox relating to that technology. For while they point to video as the organizing apparatus of the artistic practices they index, these images are of course not videos themselves, but rather stilled pictures of video printed on paper. Such intermedial objects abound in the early history of video art in Latin America, a context in which issues of technological and institutional precarity have meant that surviving video recordings from this period are unfortunately scarce. Indeed, despite the CAIC's centrality in fomenting the new art form in the region, virtually none of the tapes that the Centro and its associated artists produced during the 70s has survived. We are thus confronted with an organizing irony that structures the archive of early Latin American video. It is an archive about video that, in fact, contains very few videos and is instead full of documents like these. Documents which, while they represent the medium, also still its constitutive moving image by placing it on the static surface of the printed page. Yet, as Marin's project demonstrates, these paper translations of screen images cannot be wholly explained by questions of post facto preservation and loss either. Marin, after all, had from the start deliberately incorporated the paper mediation of video into his own network building process. His practice archived itself, we might say, as it transposed video into a paper image for the purposes of mailing it abroad. Taking these two documents as conceptual and historical bookends, what I propose to focus on in this talk, then, is precisely this intermedial irony that structures the archive of early Latin American video. Dwelling on the strangeness that arises from video's articulation on paper, I suggest, will offer a productive route from which to approach one of the few remaining video recordings that still exists from this period, produced in 1977 by Marin himself. Finally, this focus will also provide a route for considering the question to which Marin and the CAIC had both so forcefully but ambiguously gestured with their images of crowds, namely the question of video's possible politics. The trouble, however, with approaching video through the CAIC's vast corpus of printed materials is that these documents represent the medium in a highly equivocal, indeed even deceptive way. In this press release, for example, another announcement for the Centro's presentation at MoMA, the document appears to show us actual screen captures from the videotapes it mentions, with our anonymous image of the crowd appearing again on the upper left, serving this time as a type of introductory logo or emblem, a type of roaring MGM lion of the third world, announcing the content to follow. Yet this promise quickly dissolves upon closer inspection. For the images contained within the frames of the monitors below are not stilled video images, but rather photographs. The monitor on the lower left, for example, contains a photo of a sculptural work by the Argentine artist Jacques Bedel, which the Centro would later use to adorn another press release, though in this latter instance without the monitor. And indeed, this graphic signaling of video through the resource of photography is constant across the CAIC's promotional materials. While in some instances, this may have purely been a pragmatic method of representing videos which were difficult to photograph, in many other instances across the Centro's paper paraphernalia, videos are suggested where none ever existed. In countless catalogs, press releases, and promotional pamphlets, the photographic documentation of all manner of works, performances, sculptures, conceptual interventions, and so on, most of which were likely never recorded on tape, are all submitted to the device of the superimposed television frame. They are videoized, as it were, with the concept of video itself consequently emerging as an effect of the print media that apparently documents it. These acts of paper videoization might be negligible in themselves were it not for the immediate art historical context in Argentina. Beginning in the mid-60s, a collective of artists associated with Buenos Aires' Instituto de Tela would take the deceptive representation of different artistic genres through the medium of the printed press as the central conceit of a new artistic practice, which they appropriately named Arte de los Medios, or media art. In the group's inaugural work of 1966, provocatively titled Happening para un Cabalí Difunto, the artist disseminated in various Buenos Aires newspapers a press note alleging to document a happening, a genre that had recently gained popularity in Argentina. Yet the happening in question had not, in actual fact, happened. The artist had supplied the newspaper with fake documentation of an event that never occurred, and they later published a second press note exposing the deception they had perpetrated. Together, these actions made plain how the apparatus of the printed press produced the events it purported to merely report, and this act of exposure carried both political and epistemological implications. As the sociologist Eliseo Berón would write in a commentary that accompanied the artist's second press note, quote, "The systems of mass communication depend on the socially institutionalized trust in their character of, as reflections of reality. Yet they may be used for the dissemination of ideology insofar as the information that they transmit is not a reflection, but rather a selective interpretation," end quote. By deliberately amplifying the press's selective interpretive function ad absurdum, such that it literally, quote, "created its own object," Berón argued, the artists violated the public trust and, in so doing, demonstrated the press's own systematic exploitation of it. The CAIC's press releases may not have consciously emulated the experiments of the Arte de los Medios group, yet these earlier provocations structured the field of intelligibility within which those later documents circulated, and they thus inform the types of meanings they may have carried. If Happening para un Cabalí Difunto demonstrated how a happening, indeed any event, was effectively produced as a function of the newspaper that reported it, then the CAIC press releases show video as a rhetorical device configured through the internal workings of print media. Berón's theoretical writings from the 1970s provide a useful route for approaching the Centro's composite images, and I'll return to him in a moment. For now, though, it is important to note how those images emerge from Glusberg's own writings on art and media. Drawing from the popular Third Worldism movement, Glusberg characterized commercial television as a top-down, unidirectional stream of information that worked to stymie revolutionary struggles in Latin America and to prevent the formation of networks of solidarity. This asymmetrical distribution of media meant for Glusberg that, while Latin Americans may have shared a similar condition, they did not possess a platform for communicating about that condition that would result in a shared political or aesthetic project. As he would write in a major essay of 1974, quote, "Latin American art does not exist, properly speaking, but its own problematic exists in line with its revolutionary situation," end quote. Latin American interconnectedness thus figured for Glusberg not as the natural expression of an essential identity, but rather as an aspiration, as he phrased it, as a future encounter to be achieved through yet-to-be-inaugurated channels of Latin American communication. And video, with its capacity for mass screening and instant dissemination, figured as precisely the tool for forging those channels. And yet, a close analysis of the Kike's videoized image of the crowd with which I began troubles the institution's aspirational politics. The image would become the emblem for the Centro's production company, called Ediciones Tercer Mundo, or Third World Editions. By far the Kike's most widely reproduced videoized image, it appears on countless documents across the institution's archival dispersal, its image of the jostling tumult lending an air of insurrection to its articulation of a global South centered in Latin America. Yet, like all the institution's videoized images, the emblem's source is, of course, not a video, but a photograph. It was with significant effort that I was able, in fact, to track down the origin story of this particular photograph. It was taken by Pedro Rot, who at the time worked as the Kike's photographer. As Rot explained to me in 2018, he captured this image in the Buenos Aires suburb of Ezeiza on June 20th, 1973, as millions crowded the highways leading to the airport to welcome Juan Domingo Perón as he returned to Argentina after nearly 20 years in exile. The choice of the Ezeiza demonstrations as illustration for its video art initiatives was a highly enigmatic election on the Kike's part, given the political valence these events would take on. The gathering resulted in a massacre when a right-wing Peronist group opened fire on various left-wing Peronist factions congregated in the crowd, resulting in at least 13 deaths, hundreds of injuries, and the definitive collapse of the delicate coalition between right and left that the insurgent neo-Peronism had managed to hold together prior to the former president's return. By 1974, when the Kike began disseminating this photograph, videoized within a television monitor on its press releases, the events at Ezeiza would have been understood as existing within the chain of rapid political deteriorations that had precipitated the rise of the far right in the country. However, the Kike did not, I don't think, intend these specific connotations in the emblem for its video projects. Indeed, the framing of the photograph within the TV monitor has deprived it of identifying historical detail. The cropping, for example, notably obscures the texts of the banners lofted in the crowd, and the two-tone printing has rendered the three bands of the Argentine flag as an undifferentiated block of white. The image could represent any number of the strikes, uprisings, or protests that had occurred anywhere in Latin America in previous decades, or for that matter, anywhere in the so-called Tercer Mundo. And it is this vague general suggestiveness that I think the Kike intended. Though it explicitly announces video, the Kike's black and white image bears a curious resemblance to another older mass medium, that of the newspaper. Indeed, it rhymes strikingly with the photos of the same events at Ezeiza that would be published in the prominent Argentine daily La Nación, which I'm showing you here. And a comparison with this contemporaneous news source offers a useful way for understanding the operations of the videoized image. The Nación reportage is based on a series of displacements that slide across various media, announcing Perón's return and the masses congregated to greet him in its triumphant title, the newspaper relegates information on the deaths and the injuries of the massacre to a subtitle, which further obscures the identity of the groups and the political nature of the violence. The groups were composed, the press note tells us enigmatically, of elementos que están en contra del país, a designation it attributes to a statement made by then President Héctor Cámpora, it further specifies, on TV. That is, the press note displaces the verifiability of political violence and its specific character as political onto another absent medium, television. And I want to suggest that this is exactly what the Kike's videoized images do, too. Through the medium of its paper support, the press release purports to quote the medium of video, whose unique technological resources, the document announces, gives it unique political propensities. And yet its framing of the picture of these politics is paradoxically depoliticizing. Naming the political function of a medium apparently outside its own frame, the document in fact produces video as a rhetorical device internal to itself by stripping the image that constructs that device out of the specific political context from which it arose. The videoized image thus rests on a certain citational fluidity between mediums, a photograph on a printed page recruited to signal video while at once evoking the newspaper. It is a fluidity whose product is a canny picture of political resistance and the medium that apparently facilitates it, but whose effect is a political deracination of its own constitutive mediums and supports. I return at this juncture to Eliseo Berón, who, following his brief stint with the Arte de los Medios group, would go on to advocate the establishment of networks of solidarity among Latin American intellectuals, similar to those Glusberg had championed within the arts. Nevertheless, for Berón, such solidarity required a level of methodological reflexiveness that is absent from Glusberg's picture of politics. Berón drew from a structuralist orientation that understood ideology not as a set of explicit political positions, but rather as a level of signification inherent to all discourse, including the discourse of sociology itself. This is precisely what he had meant when he referred to the ideological function of the newspaper's selective interpretations in his text on happenings, which I mentioned earlier. And it is also the grounds for his critique of the US-styled functionalism that had dominated Argentine sociology throughout the 60s, which he argued had failed to take account of similar functions within its own discourse. In response, he offered a striking formulation for a sociological method that he called pragmatics. The object of study of sociology, Berón would write in an influential formulation, quote, is at another level the conditioning situation of the scientific activity directed at that object, insofar as sociology itself is a social activity, and as such, a function of the social system in which it takes place, end quote. Functionalism displaced the analysis of its own functioning within the social system out onto its description of social dynamics, which it deemed external to itself. And as such, it was incapable of offering an account of its own politics. A pragmatic sociology, Berón wrote, would take its own social functions as central objects of its own analysis. It would be, in other words, a sociology of sociology. And only then would it achieve the status of a pragmatics, whose condition, Berón would write in 1974, consists in the ability to fold back onto itself, to submit to its own analysis the discourse it has emitted. The Kike's videoized image performs something of a classic functionalist move in this regard, displacing an analysis of the political conditions of its own constituent parts onto a representation of an external politics out there somewhere. In contrast, Marín's image of the crowd might be said to offer a pragmatic picture, in Berón's sense, one whose citation of another medium serves to reflect upon the functioning of the very apparatus that has stitched it together with that foreign support. Marín's project from 1977, appropriately titled Video Post, was based on the artist's call for video art proposals from colleagues in various countries, many of whom, like Marín himself, had no independent access to video equipment. Marín then realized these proposals himself on the camera made available to him at the Museo de Arte Contemporánea da Universidad de São Paulo, subsequently photographing these tapes as he screened them on a monitor and later mailing the resulting photographs printed on diminutive cards he packed into a tiny matchbox back to the artists who had sent him the original proposals. The crowd image with which I began comes from a snapshot of the work Marín produced based on the instructions mailed to him by the Uruguayan artist Clemente Padín, who had seen in Marín's invitation an opportunity to realize what he referred to as a, quote, campaign of Latin American political sensitization. Marín, for his part, attempted to carry out Padín's instructions to the T, enacting the vandalization of a Mondrian poster within a crowded public space that the Uruguayan had specified as the catalyst for the Latin American public sensitization, though it is doubtful, based on the tape, whether such an effect was in fact achieved among the crowd. Indeed, Marín is forced to strip the poster out of its situatedness within the crowd when he brings it back into the studio to perform close-up shots of its vandalization, a clear manifestation of the limits of video recording for producing and capturing social processes. And yet the hinge to Marin's approach to the proposal comes in a sequence shortly afterward, in which the video records the envelopes in which several of the proposals, including Padin's own, had arrived. The segment constitutes a medial complement to Marin's printed, posted photograph of a video recording with which I began by offering its precise inverse, namely a video recording of a posted piece of paper. In this way, the process of the disparate mediums involved in Marin's project thus establish a mutual reflexiveness between each other that explicates how the artist's composite apparatus cobbles these mediums together in order to achieve that function so lauded by Glusberg and so apparently unique to video, that of broadcast. Marin's amalgam of mediums thus contains that pragmatic recursivity of which Berón had spoken with regard to sociology, in which sociology would take the discourse emitted through its own institutional apparatus as the object of its own analysis. Marin's interrelated supports reflect on the images emitted by one another and on the reflection of themselves produced in those images as they knit together a Latin American public. And yet this public is not to be summarized within the rhetorical device of the anonymous, tumultuous crowd. Rather, Marin's Latin American public is a geographically dispersed cohort of artists configured through the workings of a precarious coalition of different mediums and systems of circulation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Benjamin. Yeah, go right ahead and stay. I'd like to invite our other three panelists to come up here. We have time for that's my nightmare right there. I think rather than gathering questions, perhaps we'll go one at a time, and because I think we'll only have time for just a couple, which I apologize that we had some delays in the panel, but let's see, it's hard to see from up here. Is there a microphone happening? Oh, okay. Is there a microphone available? Seems like they're bringing.
No problem. Hello. My question is for Benjamin. Thank you very much for your wonderful presentation and the very detailed archival research you've done. I just wanted to perhaps suggest an alternative reading of that kind of very evocative image of the crowds in the Ceiza. I believe maybe that rather than it being apolitical, it could actually very well symbolize the Glusberg's own politics, which kind of flirted with both the extreme right and the extreme left, which were both present in that demonstration. And furthermore, that it kind of may be read as a commentary on the politics of technology themselves, which is like, it's not that TV is in itself conservative and video radical, but you know, some of the essential readings of the politics of technologies have argued, but actually that both can be taken in either direction. I mean, I think your interpretation is fair and well argued, but maybe like it could be expanded into that other sort of more conflicted reading that, you know, is there. But anyway, thank you for the presentations of everybody.
Would you like to respond if you'd like to?
Yeah, thank you very much for that question. I can't see you now, whoever you are. Oh, hello. Thank you. I really appreciate that. I think you're totally right that the politics in these Kike materials are equivocal politics. It's never clear what side of the spectrum they in fact lie on and what you know, specific political causes they are, you know, comprometidos. But I think that is the point I'm trying to get to when I call it a picture of politics. It's an evocation of the idea of politics without actually specifying a politics, without actually explaining, you know, what the position of this institution is. So I think maybe I agree with you, but have just said it in a different way. But thank you for that.
Okay, thank you. And
I think we have another question.
La mía es para Leslie Wolf. Bueno, me parece muy interesante.
Sí. Madeline Turner, sí.
Ah, perdón, sí. Para Madeline. Ajá. Muy interesante la presentación. Y bueno, quería hacer como una pregunta y luego como un poco más un comentario. La pregunta es, ¿con qué otros archivos piensas que puede convivir este archivo que ya tienes de los papeles de Jesús A. Rodríguez? Como, ¿con qué archivo puede dialogar? Y como en esa pregunta, yo pensaba en que sería muy interesante tal vez encontrar algún archivo, algún documento, algo que esté resguardado en algún lugar, que esté desde la perspectiva de los censores. Pensar tal vez en alguna publicación católica, que aquí en México hay muchísimas, tal vez en, no sé, en incluso en los archivos del gobierno, porque muy seguramente Jesús A. Rodríguez fue seguida por el gobierno y debe haber un expediente en ese momento ya no estaba la DFS, pero ya estaban su sucesor, y esos papeles se están liberando poco a poco, ¿no? No sé en qué momento de la investigación estés, pero quizá en algún punto puedas llegar a 1988, porque ahorita está desclasificado hasta 1985. Entonces, a mí me parecería muy padre ver tal vez el expediente, ¿no?, de Jesús A. Rodríguez y de la colectiva, de las divas, estaría genial. Y bueno, luego también pensaba en que pues esta persecución desde lo católico pues tiene mucho que ver con también quién estaba desde la presidencia, ¿no? Porque pues en México hay una larga historia de relación entre la Iglesia Católica y el gobierno. Y pues no, yo creo que no es gratuito que justo en el 88 llega Salinas a la presidencia y pues es el presidente que restablece relaciones con el Vaticano, que renueva relaciones oficiales, ¿no?, entre Iglesia y Estado. Entonces, bueno, esa era como la pregunta, y tal vez si te aporta en algo como la idea de estos archivos, nada más.
¿Contesto ahora? Muchísimas gracias por esos comentarios. Para contestar la pregunta es que con cuáles otros archivos podrían vivir este archivo, esta pregunta, ¿no? Bueno, es muy buena pregunta. Honestamente, no he pensado mucho en ese tema, solamente más en términos de, estoy pensando más en términos de la relación de este archivo con archivos de arte o archivos de performance. Así que, por ejemplo, yo hice un montón de trabajo en Arkea acá y pensé quizás eso podía ser un lugar, pero al final llegué a la conclusión que no es el lugar para un archivo así, porque de hecho Jesús, su trabajo ocupa un lugar en el intermedio, ¿no?, entre el teatro, entre el performance, también a veces con el arte visual. Así que creo que de hecho un archivo de lo político es el lugar para este archivo. Y la última parte de tu pregunta, perdón. Ok, muchas gracias.
¿Tenemos tiempo para una más?
My question is for Joseph. Una pregunta para Joseph. Quería saber más. I wanted to know more about images or any sort of visual collection or documentation of Madame Sata, or just the drag performances. Porque nomás quería saber un poco más de imágenes o any sort of archival stuff, algo del archivo que tiene imágenes sobre the drag performances.
Thank you so much. This is very much kind of like pandemic research, so the question remains to be answered. I kind of follow in the footsteps of many folks who have done a bit of archival work around Francisco de Santis. And yet, the kind of like visual archival trace of him from this. Estamos bien? Okay. The archival trace from these decades that I'm most interested in, to my knowledge, is absent. Same with the kind of like drag politics, because up until 40, that was very much criminalized in Rio. And so the optimist in me wants to believe that there's more out there, but in the meantime, I'm kind of interested in pressing on this question of what kind of project we can make from the traces available to us, but I'll keep you posted.
And yeah, puedo preguntar very briefly, I want to also just pose a final question to Cecilia about your work and how it intersects with your curation, and asking about how these geological archives, it goes along with what Joseph was just talking about, how you actually implement, what sorts of strategies you use to think through geological archives in terms of the materiality in the exhibition that you worked on. If you could talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, thank you. Like really briefly, a lot of the time. The exhibition is multimodal, so I am using a lot of different media and a lot of different media. Do you hear me okay?
Yeah, I can hear you, but I have to hear you with the transmission.
But I think that is why they unmuted, so I think they are hearing it. So apart from the actual pieces, I have asked all the artists to submit some sort of experiential thing to every artwork. So we are working with clotheslines and textile. Also performance, so all these things, I feel like they kind of render a better idea of this relationship that I'm talking about in talking about the geological. So, and also performances with the actual nature, we're going to bodies of water and things like that.
That's very interesting. Well, thank you all very much. Muchísimas gracias a todos. Y acabo de empezar el próximo panel ya, entonces, stay and
les pedimos por favor permanecer en sus asientos. Vamos a recibir unas palabras de la directora del Museo Franz Mayer.
video for YouTube.
Sí, perfecto.
Ay, ya veo los lunares en mi chaqueta ahí detrás de las cabecitas, ya. Y no, pero yo no oigo nada de lo que pasa. Te oigo a ti, pero no oigo lo que está pasando en la mesa.
Ok, a ver, ahorita prendo el micrófono. Síguele.
Uno, dos, tres, probando. Uno, dos, tres, probando. Uno, dos, tres.
Síguele, Adri.
Uno. Uno.
¿Otra vez? ¿Se escucha? ¿Blanca no escuchó?
Sí, yo lo tengo, pero lo oigo mal. A ti lo oigo muy bien, pero lo que pasa en la mesa lo oigo mal, lo oigo con eco.
Okay.
Muy lejano.
Habla en el micro, 1, 2, 3. A ver, ahí va la palabra. ¿Se oye?
Se oye robótico.
Sí. Ok. Creo, sí, 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 creo que le voy a pedir que me ayude escuchando por YouTube.
Vale, perfecto.
Sí, exacto, la cámara se queda prendida, por favor.
Ok. Y conecto YouTube, pero obviamente cuando empecé a hablar, quito YouTube para no
cerrar.
Ok, vale, entendido, gracias.
Gracias.
Hola, Muy buenas tardes a todas y a todos. Esta es una bienvenida tardía y es un poco mañoso en realidad, porque dijimos, bueno, dar la bienvenida al museo justo después de comer, era seguro que íbamos a hacer, vaya, la doctora, Luis y su servidora para dar la bienvenida y no hubiera estado tan bien. Entonces nos esperamos un poquito a que de verdad estuviéramos todos para poder darles oficialmente la bienvenida a este museo. Mi nombre es Giovanna Jaspersen y tengo la gran fortuna de dirigir este espacio y además de eso de poderlo conocer desde distintos puntos, es decir, hace 15 años estuve en este mismo museo, en el taller de conservación y restauración, conociendo muchas de las cosas que hacemos, sus acervos, sus documentos, sus colecciones, pero desde la otra puerta. Poder regresar ahora me permite también saber cuál es la diferencia y la singularidad de este espacio frente a otros museos en México, y por lo que también nos interesaba tanto sumarnos a este espacio de diálogo, de construcción de conocimiento común y poder ir en alianza con el Instituto de Investigaciones Estéticas, sumándonos a la construcción de archivos vivos. El Museo Franz Mayer, a diferencia de otros museos, tiene un archivo documental no únicamente de la figura de Franz Mayer, en tanto que coleccionista, sino también de Ruth de Lechuga, como coleccionista también de arte popular. A esto se sumó también el archivo de Palen, y con ello la documentación de la primera exposición internacional de surrealismo en México. Estos acervos, si los vemos de manera convencional, podríamos decir, bueno, tienen acervos, tienen colecciones. Sin embargo, yo creo que ahí radica la verdadera diferencia entre que nosotros tengamos un objeto, un museo donde acumulamos cosas, donde tenemos objetos ordenados con algún sentido, y que podamos tener un museo que en realidad pueda tener alma. Cuando veíamos las colecciones de Franz Mayer, cuando las vemos de lejos, podemos pensar este afán de acumulación y únicamente tener más y más y más objetos. Cuando vemos, por ejemplo, cómo nace la colección de Quijotes más grande de México y una de las más importantes de América Latina, probablemente la segunda abierta al público, y leemos en su correspondencia, solo me interesa de la forma en que me interesan todas las cosas bellas. Y nos damos cuenta de que su aproximación fue a través de la literatura, no fue a través de la literatura, sino de la belleza, de las formas, de los grabados, y que esto hizo que finalmente tuviera más de 700 Quijotes y que ahora podamos utilizarlos también como una manera de acercarlos al libro o como vínculo, nos lleva a comprender la colección y su vida de manera distinta. Es decir, justamente estos archivos son los que convierten nuestro acervo en carne, pero también a Franz Mayer. Es decir, a través de sus fotos lo vemos con sus amigos, sabemos qué tomaba, sabemos el café que enviaba a Europa, qué mandaba de obsequio a otras personas, pero también las recetas de María escritas de puño, cómo recibía a las personas en su casa, quiénes fueron sus amigos, qué comían, por qué compró determinadas piezas y no otras, en qué momento renunció a las tendencias mundiales y dijo: la verdad es que a mí el grabado de los Países Bajos ya no me interesa, me interesa el arte novohispano. Quiero que mi colección vaya únicamente hacia lo virreinal, hacia lo novohispano, y que a partir de eso comenzara a hacer una revisión crítica de descarte, en el cual incluso iba tomando una nueva personalidad en su propio proceso de mexicanización. Lo mismo nos sucede con Ruth de Lechuga, y con un archivo que nos deja ver todos los objetos que tenemos vivos. Es decir, de la misma forma que hoy podemos hacer un cruce entre los artesanos que están en el patio central y ustedes hablando de documentos o de investigación, de la misma forma podemos tener nuestras máscaras, las fotografías de estas máscaras siendo usadas, siendo bailadas, y saber exactamente en qué sitio se bailó y quién fue su mascarero, de la misma forma en que pueden regresar los artesanos después de 60 años al Franz Mayer y habitarlo de manera digna, de manera festiva, y saber que ellos son la parte viva de esta tradición que tenemos en todas nuestras salas y en cada uno de los archivos documentales, y que queremos justamente que siga estando viva, que siga estando visitada y que se siga construyendo a diario. Así, es un gran gusto poder darles la bienvenida. Que sepan que cuenten con nosotros y que sepan también que siempre es su casa. Muchas gracias.
Hola, ok. Gracias, Giovanna, por tu amable acogida y gracias al Museo Franz Mayer por acoger a la última día de la sexta trienal de ALA. Buenas tardes y bienvenidos de nuevo. Soy Joana Reyes, la secretaria tesorera de ALA, y estoy encantada de estar aquí moderando este interesante panel. En los últimos días hemos visto las fantásticas posibilidades del archivo. Un tema en particular que ha surgido repetidamente es el potencial disruptivo del archivo. Ya sea luchando contra las narrativas hegemónicas y corrigiendo los borrones, o reimaginando lo que constituye un archivo, nuestros participantes han aportado amplios puntos de vista sobre el potencial radical de sus respectivos trabajos. En las ponencias que siguen, las ponentes analizarán cómo los nuevos enfoques del archivo en el presente remodelan nuestra comprensión del pasado. Este panel contará con tres presentaciones a cargo de cinco ponentes. Nuestra primera ponente es Idore Alonso. Idore is Curator of Latin American Collections at the Getty Research Institute. Previously, she was Curator at the Museum of Latin American Art, MOLA, where she organized numerous exhibitions. In 2015, she was awarded, together with Celine Preciado, the Emerging Curator Award from the Los Angeles Contemporary Exhibitions. Alonso worked on two exhibitions as part of the Pacific Standard Time Los Angeles Latin America Initiative in 2017, and recently inaugurated Reinventing the Americas, Construct, Erase, Repeat at the Getty Research Institute. And I believe you're expecting to receive your PhD this year? That was in the notes? Okay, sorry. Bueno, demos la bienvenida a nuestra primera oradora, Idore Alonso.
You made it to the last panel, congratulations. Yo también quería agradecer a la organización, a ALA, al Instituto de Estéticas por este simposio que ha sido realmente fantástico y que nos vamos con un montón de información. Bueno, yo voy a hablar un poco de Reinventing the Americas. Quisiera empezar mi ponencia con algo que el artista indígena Denilson Baniwa me compartió acerca de su trabajo. Cuando era niño y vivía todavía en el pueblo de mi comunidad, me forzaron a ir a una escuela del gobierno. En esa escuela yo tuve acceso al conocimiento occidental. En esta escuela en particular, la enseñanza de arte era muy importante, y ahí pensé lo mágico que era para un artista construir una imagen o representación de sus pensamientos. Por aquel entonces no entendía que el artista crea narrativas que a veces, o la mayoría del tiempo, no se corresponden con la realidad, que el arte es también un estado de poder. Y cuando entendí eso, comencé a pensar en cómo mi trabajo podría ser importante para mi comunidad. Así que como artista tengo un deseo, pensar en otra historia. ¿Cómo puedo crear una narrativa en la que me sienta incluido? Me planteé algunas preguntas similares cuando hace 5 años empecé a trabajar en la que finalmente sería la exposición Reinventing the Americas, Construct, Delete, Repeat, presentada en el Getty Research Institute en Los Ángeles el año pasado. Existen dos cuestiones importantes que debo recalcar. Por un lado, que las exposiciones que el GRI, el Getty Research Institute, realiza, se centran en sus colecciones y que los amplios acervos del archivo ya existían cuando yo llegué a la institución como la primera curadora de arte latinoamericano. Con esto quiero decir que yo debía trabajar con unos materiales existentes en los que percibía varias omisiones y vacíos. Reinventing the Americas analizaba el imaginario de América que se había generado a través de las ilustraciones y grabados europeos desde el siglo XVI al XIX. La premisa de la muestra, establecida en parte con las ideas del libro de 1958 del historiador mexicano Edmundo O'Gorman, La invención de América, es que América es una invención europea. Y como prueba de ello, la exposición presentaba la forma en que conquistadores, cronistas, viajeros y artistas ilustraron y describieron los recursos naturales y a la gente local del continente, construyendo en muchas ocasiones ideas fantásticas y ficticias. Mezclando la realidad con sus propias convenciones e interpretaciones, crearon imágenes reproducibles que circularon alrededor del mundo, diseminando estereotipos y prejuicios que sobreviven hasta la actualidad. En realidad, el tema de la exposición no era innovador. Existe un buen número de publicaciones académicas que tratan estas cuestiones. Se habían realizado también varias exposiciones con objetos similares a los nuestros, incluyendo The European Vision of America, organizada por the Cleveland Museum of Art, o New Worlds of Wonder, European Images of the Americas, por the Folger Shakespeare Library. Sin embargo, había habido en estos proyectos expositivos una falta de posicionamiento crítico. ¿De qué forma entonces podríamos presentar nuestros objetos apelando a los matices de su significación, tanto en su época de producción como en la contemporaneidad? ¿Cómo se podía contrarrestar la monovisión europea de los materiales en nuestra colección? ¿De qué manera producir una exposición con estos objetos que reiterase la exclusión contenida en las narrativas de los mismos? Decidí invitar al artista Denilson Baniwa a participar en el proyecto. Denilson es parte del grupo indígena de los Baniwas, en la zona brasileña del Amazonas, que colinda con Venezuela y Colombia, y en la que conviven otros 23 pueblos indígenas. El trabajo que Denilson realizaba funcionaba particularmente bien para la exposición, ya que venía utilizando en su obra imágenes coloniales y del siglo XIX, muchas de ellas parte de los materiales presentes en nuestra colección. Su trabajo con objetos históricos se ha enfocado en sobreponer dibujos, imágenes, textos, también en eliminar y borrar, haciendo más visible las cuestiones problemáticas de las obras históricas, especialmente en cuanto a la representación de indígenas brasileños y la colonización. Aquí les comparto algunas imágenes de su obra anterior, en donde pueden ver cómo utiliza este tipo de materiales coloniales del siglo XIX. El punto de partida en mi conversación con Denilson fue que insertase su voz en la narrativa de la exposición, y para ello realizó una serie de intervenciones sobre los objetos de la colección. Creó dos videos, varios murales y una instalación final con la que se cerraba el recorrido de la muestra. Para acceder a la sala de exposiciones, el visitante caminaba frente al primer mural de Denilson Baniwa, realizado usando un mapa de América, parte del que es considerado el primer atlas moderno, un libro del cartógrafo holandés Abraham Ortelius del siglo XVI. En la obra, Denilson borró uno por uno, usando tinta negra, a manera de gesto censor, cada uno de los nombres de los lugares del mapa dados por los colonizadores, y añadió en el norte y Suramérica tierra indígena en letras blancas. Además, cambió la información de la leyenda en la parte de arriba, en la que escribió History of Violations, o Historia de las Violaciones. En un gesto satírico, en algunos de los barcos, el artista añadió calaveras, relacionando las naves de los colonizadores con piratas. Este mural encapsulaba las principales ideas que Denilson desarrolló a lo largo del recorrido de la muestra: la inserción de elementos, la eliminación de otros, el uso del humor negro y el incesante recordatorio de que América es territorio ocupado y colonizado. Al mismo tiempo, invité a miembros latinos de la comunidad local de Los Ángeles, cuya herencia e historia tenía que ver con las imágenes de la muestra, a ser parte de la exposición. Una de mis preocupaciones desde que llegué al GRI ha sido la desconexión de la institución con las comunidades locales y el desconocimiento sobre nuestras colecciones latinoamericanas en la misma comunidad latina. Esta fue una manera en la que nos acercamos a grupos que no suelen tener relación con el GRI. En primer lugar, incluí a los trabajadores del Getty. Colaboré con los jardineros, cuyo departamento tiene el mayor número de trabajadores latinoamericanos y con los que yo tenía una historia de relación que había venido cultivando en los últimos 5 años. Esa es otra cuestión que podemos hablar más tarde. Salvador Álvarez, Arturo Cuevas, Federico Mora y Efraín Pérez eligieron 4 piezas y hablamos de sus impresiones sobre ellas. Grabé nuestra conversación y, usando sus propias palabras, escribí las cartelas de los objetos. Llevé a cabo esta misma operación con otras 3 personas, Yesa Calderón, cantautora y escritora parte de los grupos indígenas Xumas y Tonga de California, Lilia Ramírez, artista chicana del grupo de artistas Mujeres del Maíz, y Jorge Gutiérrez, fundador de Familia Trans Queer Liberation Movement, una asociación dedicada a ayudar a los inmigrantes latinos queer y trans. Las cartelas muestran respuestas muy personales a los objetos y rompen con la voz solemne institucional del museo y de la curadora. La cartela que el visitante leía junto a los primeros cuatro grabados de la exposición que en la muestra que mostraban la llegada de los colonizadores a América, un grabado de Johannes Stradanus, un artista flamenco que trabajó en la corte de los Medici en el siglo XVI, se completaba con las palabras de Salvador, Arturo, Federico y Efraín. La mayoría de la historia no es realidad, parte es verdad y parte es imaginación. Y así se escribe la historia, de contar una milésima de verdad y muchas mentiras, en este caso inventadas para atraer a los europeos a América. A estas cuatro obras les acompañaba un audio, un extracto de la carta de Cristóbal Colón al rey Fernando de España, escrita en 1493 tras su llegada a América. La española es maravilla, las sierras y las montañas y las vegas y las campiñas y las tierras tan hermosas y gruesas para plantar y sembrar, para criar ganado de todas suertes, para edificios de villas y lugares. Los puertos de la mar aquí no habría creencia sin vista, y de los ríos muchos y grandes y buenas aguas, los más de los cuales traen oro. Este texto sobre América introduce la noción de fantasía, los ríos llenos de oro, América como el paraíso, estableciéndose como la primera invención del continente por parte de los europeos. Si pensamos que la mayoría de las piezas presentes en la exposición fueron creadas por artistas que jamás viajaron a América, entenderemos no solo el papel fundamental que las descripciones y crónicas tuvieron en generar un imaginario, sino en el concepto de reinvención en el que se basaba la exposición. A través de la guía auditiva de la exposición, añadí otros tres textos de las crónicas en los que se describía ciertas características presentadas en las obras. De esta manera, en Reinventing aparecen varias voces en diferentes niveles: los objetos de la época en sí, las crónicas antiguas, las intervenciones de Denilson y las reacciones de la comunidad a las imágenes. La primera sección de Reinventing revisaba la construcción de la alegoría de América, generada desde el siglo XVI y que se repite incesantemente durante los siguientes tres siglos. América se presenta como una mujer desnuda, lo que indica a los espectadores europeos sus hábitos salvajes y bárbaros, a diferencia de las tradiciones cristianas. Lleva plumas y algún arma, un arco y una flecha o el garrote tupinamba. Aparecen miembros de cuerpos o cabezas decapitadas a su alrededor, en alusión a la práctica del canibalismo y su naturaleza violenta, y se presentan también animales americanos junto a ella, como loros, caimanes, armadillos, perezosos, osos hormigueros. La maca, un objeto inventado por los indígenas, es también común en estas representaciones. Y aquí se pueden ver el oso hormiguero, el perezoso, detrás pueden ver también gente que está en una quemando una pierna. Aquí otras dos imágenes. En esta sección, Denilson llevó a cabo dos intervenciones sobre los objetos. La primera en el frontispicio del libro de Ortelius y la segunda usando dos esculturas alegóricas. A través del uso de un papel negro, el artista cubrió varias zonas de la imagen, dejando únicamente al descubierto las cuatro figuras alegóricas: Europa arriba, Asia y África a los lados y América en el inferior. Nuevamente cambió el título de la pieza, que pasó a denominarse Therapy for All o Terapia para Todos, con el subtítulo Illustration of the Victims. Para las dos esculturas, Denilson creó unos espejos que deformaban la imagen que reflejaban y además utiliza la imagen del caimán. Y cada uno de los objetos intervenidos por Denilson tenían también su huella en la cartela de información sobre la pieza. Usando un Sharpie, el artista modificó los títulos e incluyó su nombre al escribir FT Featuring, Denilson Banigua, junto al nombre del artista original, como si se tratase de un artista invitado a realizar una colaboración, que eso se usa mucho en la música ahora. De esta forma, Denilson borraba abruptamente una historia, dejándola todavía parcialmente visible, y se introducía a sí mismo en ella. Ahí se ve un video también que hizo. La siguiente sección temática de la exposición se centraba en la representación de los indígenas y en la forma en que su imagen fue construida. Estas ilustraciones muestran a los habitantes de América como salvajes, algunos inocentes y otros violentos. Los artistas utilizaron tradiciones europeas para retratar a la gente local. El arte antiguo, romano y griego fue en muchas ocasiones la fuente de la idealización de sus cuerpos. Pero en general hay una homogeneización en los retratos que refleja la falta de interés de los artistas por investigar la apariencia única de los individuos de diferentes zonas geográficas. Como en la alegoría de América, los indígenas eran representados desnudos, con plumas y rodeados de elementos locales. Con la intención de recalcar su naturaleza bárbara, las alusiones al canibalismo, sacrificios humanos en cuanto a la zona de México y la práctica de la idolatría eran comunes. Las primeras crónicas no solo se fijaron en la gente local, también se abocaron a recalcar el mundo natural y la riqueza de América. La tercera parte de la muestra examinaba las historias naturales producidas durante la época colonial en la que se describían nuevas plantas y animales. La sección abría con una intervención de Denilson sobre la historia natural de Brasil de Willem Piso. Esta publicación fue el resultado de la exploración científica liderada por el conde John Maurice de Nassau durante la ocupación holandesa de Pernambuco en Brasil entre 1637 y 1644. Denilson nuevamente tapaba diferentes áreas de la ilustración para que el espectador se fijase en la pareja indígena y en la escena de idolatría en el centro. Al mismo tiempo cambió el título del libro a Historia Natural de la Colonización, haciendo hincapié en la parte que está oculta bajo las empresas científicas de la época. En relación a esta idea que planteaba Denilson, uno de los aspectos que fue importante recalcar en esta sección es que la abundancia de los recursos naturales en América llevó a su explotación, algo que está directamente conectado con el uso de trabajos forzados y el comienzo de la esclavitud. La apertura de minas de oro y plata, el cultivo de la caña, de azúcar, tabaco y café, la extracción de productos locales transformaron el paisaje local, generando daños duraderos en su geografía. La muestra incluía una sección sobre las imágenes de la conquista. Las narrativas que describían los primeros contactos entre las dos civilizaciones escondieron el shock y los efectos catastróficos de la colonización, incluyendo la supresión de las culturas locales, la conversión de indígenas al catolicismo y la práctica de la esclavitud. Sin embargo, algunas representaciones y crónicas fueron críticas con la conquista, algo especialmente visible en las ilustraciones producidas desde la Europa protestante. Uno de los talleres más importantes en cuanto a la producción de imágenes sobre América estuvo dirigido por Theodor de Brie y su familia en Frankfurt. Entre 1590 y 1634, su taller creó más de 600 grabados en cobre para ilustrar 13 volúmenes sobre las Américas. Los grabados, difundidos y copiados extensamente a lo largo de varios siglos, señalaban la brutalidad de los españoles en el continente. Esta visión estaba directamente conectada con las guerras de religión que estaban sucediendo en Europa en la época. De Brie era protestante calvinista en un momento de polarización religiosa y debido a sus creencias fue forzado a salir de su país natal en los Países Bajos. Denilson intervino una de las ilustraciones de esa sección en la que se muestra el momento en que Vasco Núñez de Balboa manda echar a los perros a los indígenas para que sean devorados vivos. El artista transformó a los conquistadores en perros al ponerles cabezas de canes usando nuevamente la sátira, ya que los dibujos que realizaba parecen salidos de una película de Disney. El artista dice que la obra tiene un cierto carácter retributivo. En la lengua baniwa existe la palabra ricuada, comentaba. La traducción es algo así como el karma, cuando la acción de alguien sobre otra persona desencadena toda una serie de consecuencias. Entonces, en las personas indígenas que están siendo torturadas, incorporo sus espíritus saliendo y transformándose en seres que buscarán su propia venganza. Aquí hay algunas imágenes, no tengo tiempo para hablar de esto, pero el diseño de la exposición también fue importante dentro de la narrativa curatorial de la muestra. Como verán, usamos un formato muy contemporáneo para unas piezas que no son contemporáneas. La última sección de Reinventing se adentraba en un periodo diferente, mirando a la producción de los viajeros europeos en el siglo XIX. Como en siglos anteriores, la mayoría de los visitantes percibían el continente como una tierra rica en recursos, habitada por gente, entre comillas, primitiva. Sus estudios se enfocaron principalmente en describir el potencial beneficio económico que podría hacerse de la región, y con ese objetivo, muchos de estos viajeros generaron análisis exhaustivos de las culturas locales y sus riquezas naturales. En contraste con el periodo colonial, los viajeros del siglo XIX usaron un acercamiento más científico en sus escritos e ilustraciones. Sin embargo, el desarrollo de teorías biológicas falsas y el racismo científico generó numerosas clasificaciones de humanos. En general, los grupos indígenas locales y afrodescendientes eran deshumanizados, retratados como objetos de estudio. Y aquí hay dos ejemplos. Reinventing finalizaba con un mural y una instalación de Denilson. La instalación representaba la forma tradicional en que se han mostrado objetos de otras culturas en museos, herencia de los gabinetes de curiosidades armados por las clases altas europeas entre los siglos XVI y XVIII. Tal y como comenta Denilson, el gabinete de curiosidades siempre se utilizó como elemento de poder del colonizador para hacer que los pueblos nativos parecieran exóticos. Su obra imitaba en su presentación uno de estos dispositivos utilizando objetos de diferentes comunidades indígenas del Amazonas que Denilson había intervenido. La información sobre los objetos era falsa, tanto los años de producción como de dónde provienen las piezas, puesto que ninguno de ellos era parte de colecciones de museos europeos, como decían las cartelas. Con esta instalación y como había hecho a lo largo de toda la muestra, Denilson obligaba a que el observador tuviese que pararse a observar detenidamente para entender lo que los objetos significaban realmente. Frente al gabinete de curiosidades, Denilson creó este mural con tiza en el que narraba la historia de la creación desde la perspectiva banigua. El comienzo de Reinventing the Americas, con la carta de Cristóbal Colón, y el final, con el mural de Denilson Banigua, evidencian el hecho de que las reinvenciones de América jamás fueron estáticas, homogéneas ni lineales, y confirman también que seguimos reinventando América hoy en día. Mi propuesta con esta exposición fue, usando el término fantástico utilizado ayer por María Juana, sacudir el archivo, dar una nueva visión usando los materiales de nuestro archivo, crear otra reinvención en la que las voces y perspectivas de aquellos que históricamente no estuvieron ni están representados pasasen a formar parte de esta historia sumamente compleja. Gracias. Y este es un video que está en la página web, si lo quieren ver, sobre Denilson que hicimos. Pero no lo voy a poner.
Gracias, Irene. Bueno, la segunda presentación correrá a cargo de las coponentes Adriana Zafala y Delia Cosentino. Adriana Zafala is Associate Professor of Art History at Tufts University, where she also directs the Consortium of Studies in Race, Colonialism, and Diaspora. She earned a PhD in Art History from Brown University. Her book, Becoming Modern, Becoming Tradition, Women, Gender, and Representation in Mexican Art, won the Arvey Prize from ALA in 2011. She's curated several exhibitions and is also the founding director of the US Latinx Art Forum. Her current co-authored project, Resurrecting Tenochtitlan, will be released by UT Press in May. Her co-presenter and co-author of that book, Delia Cosentino, is Associate Professor of Latin American Art History at DePaul University, where she specializes in the visual culture of Greater Mexico. And Delia received her PhD at UCLA. She's author of Las Joyas de Cena Cantempec, Arte Colonial en el Monasterio de San Miguel, and editor of Cartographic Styles and Discourse. She has curated multiple exhibitions, including Ceramic Trees of Life, Popular Art from Mexico at the Fowler Museum at UCLA, and several more at DePaul University. So join me in welcoming Adriana Zafala and Delia Cosentino.
Sorry, while Delia is getting set up. Agradecemos muchísimo esta oportunidad. Ha sido un placer estar aquí con ustedes y gracias a todos que ha organizado en este evento. Gracias.
Thank you so much. So, good afternoon. We're excited to share just a small sliver of ideas from this forthcoming book. which explores how artists, scholars, and government officials attempted to assert connections to the Aztec or Mexica capital as part of the reassessment of post-revolutionary national identity. We identify a conceptual excavation of Tenochtitlan in relation to the transforming urban landscape to produce the idea of a mestizo Mexico City in the present. In the book, we look at the period from 1914 to 1964, beginning with Manuel Gamio's discovery of a corner of the Templo Mayor and ending with the opening of the Museo Nacional de Antropología. A key underlying fact of our study is that from the mid-19th century through the first half of the 20th century, Mexico City expands exponentially. This is when the city most clearly outgrows its original footprint, first established by the Mexica. It stayed largely faithful to this geography until the middle of the 19th century, as seen in this Porfirian period map. The detail in red on the right shows its more contained urban plan in the early 19th century. Against this backdrop of industrialization, our work considers two critical groups, among other actors, in a formative social collaboration that most clearly resulted in the revival of Tenochtitlan in the modern city. We look at art historians who collaborated with urban planners to shape views of the past and future city, and artists whose work in two and three dimensions helped to construct a complex social spatial profile for the modern city through imaginative visual projection. What brings us here is that these two interconnected groups of thinkers benefited from expanded access to critical archival documents, which deeply affected their understanding of the changing city. In fact, we argue that the early 20th century rediscovery and circulation of both visual and textual materials from the first century of Spanish control resulted in a transformative spatial consciousness that challenged the notion that Mexico City was a Spanish construct. Instead, new knowledge opened the door to the idea that the modern capital is mestizo, with Tenochtitlan as its foundation. Perhaps the most significant body of historic documents came through the renowned historian Francisco del Paso y Troncoso, whose decades in various European archives yielded crucial sources for making sense of Mexican space. This included, for instance, this early 17th century map of Mexico City by Juan Gomez de Trasmonte on the left here, and pages from Sahagún's 16th century Primeros Memoriales, including this rendition of the sacred precinct. In both cases, Paso y Troncoso commissioned lithographic reproductions in Florence in the first decade of the 20th century, and these images and many others circulated back to Mexico in full color. These and many more documents unearthed by Paso y Troncoso proved crucial for art historians in particular. Their attention to the city's foundations was acute because of concerns over historic preservation of churches in the urban core. Thus, they took a special interest in historic maps. Key among these figures were Manuel Toussaint, founder of the Instituto de Investigaciones Estéticas, with Federico Gómez de Orozco, and Toussaint's colleague and successor at Estéticas, Justino Fernández. Significantly, both collaborated with Carlos Contreras, the nation's first official urban planner. These collaborations reached an apex when they created twin texts for the 6th Annual Housing and Town Planning Congress at Bellas Artes in 1938. Organized by Contreras, who authored a monograph containing a decade of development plans for Mexico City. The other volume was Planos de la Ciudad de México, collaboration of the art historians. The evidence of the collaboration is evident in the fact that Contreras wrote the introduction to Planos, and as Alejandrina Escudero points out, Fernández drew all the maps for Contreras's monograph. A closer look at Planos shows the impact of transformative spatial consciousness through access to archival materials. First of all, it was the first in-depth modern assessment of the capital's earliest maps. And some of those we will see a bit later, including the Uppsala map in the upper screen there, as well as the Cortez map on the side here. Two
other maps located by Paso y Troncoso in the Archivo de las Indias in Seville set up the premise of the book. That is, that the study of the sequence of historic maps could reveal the morphology of the city. Here, Toussaint uses these two maps of the plans of the plaza to demonstrate the concept of city as process, noting the growing size and appearance of the buildings around that space from one to the next. And he notes, you can clearly appreciate a progress from the previous plan. More broadly, the use of historic maps to show such changes was intended to continue with the subsequent volume dedicated to the 18th and 19th century maps of the city, but that volume never materialized. I think it's important to note here an observation by Arturo Almandoz Marte, who notes that whereas in the United States and elsewhere, urban history derived from economic and social mainstreams, the history of art provided the first substratum for Latin America's urban history. And I think that the work leading up to and culminating in the Planos volume is evidence of art history's role in establishing the urban history in Mexico. One more really fun fact is that the Planos volume may, in fact, have saved Estéticas from disillusion, according to Fernandez, when the UNAM was restructured in 1937 because the authors convinced authorities to allow it to stay open at least until they had completed the volume. One final archival source, perhaps most conceptually important for the art historians, were the legal files for the 16th century land grant Mercedes belonging to descendants of Alonso García Bravo. He was a comrade of Cortes, selected to design the Spanish Traza after the fall of Tenochtitlan. And engineer Jose Benitez, who was part of Contreras's planning committee, documented the newly unearthed García Bravo materials in this 1933 book. Toussaint would later also write a book on the topic. And although few tangible details are known about García Bravo, knowledge of a specific person who helped to shape the city and perhaps its single most transformational moment allowed contemporary thinkers to consider in a newly dynamic way the historical realities of actually laying out an urban plan. They could now imagine, in fact, a parallel between contemporary urban planning in their own city and the choices that shaped its earliest phases. Contreras was, in some ways, the 20th century Alonso García Bravo. To demonstrate how these realizations shaped the views of the early art historians working with historic maps, let's look at the so-called Cortes map of Tenochtitlan, the well-known woodcut of 1524, single best circulated view of the Aztec capital city, long familiar to a Mexican audience. Barbara Mundi, of course, clarified its creation in Nuremberg, while Toussaint in the Planos volume thought it was created by a Spanish eyewitness to the war. But beyond this, Toussaint and Fernandez proposed a significant new take on the map as seen through the lens of both Aztec and Spanish planning approaches. Seen through the lens of Aztec planning, modern viewers of the Cortes map could now see the design principles at work in Tenochtitlan and the sense of space created by these conscious choices. This was a groundbreaking take. Through the map, Toussaint describes the Aztec city in glowing terms, identifying a perfect system of axes with four spectacular roads leading to the center, as we can see in the woodcut. His imaginary journey was definitely aided by recent excavations confirming the exact location of the Templo Mayor. Here, as illustrated by Ignacio Marquina, Toussaint imagines what it would feel like to approach the sacred center from one of the causeways or to pass through the living space of the city. He writes, from a distance, whatever the path followed, one could see the enormous mass of the great temple as the end of the trip and as the traveler's hope. He praises Mexica designers, not only as perfect urban planners, but also as true artists. And he later declares, although the chroniclers say that the indigenous city was totally destroyed, every day we are convinced that this assertion is not exact. Toussaint, Fernandez, and Gomez de Orozco also saw the Cortes map through the lens of Spanish planning. Outside, the outsized sacred precinct registers priorities of European eyes, those of Cortes, his Spanish allies, the woodcutter, and its audience. Spaniards were most interested in the center of power, of course, plotting their own plan to replace it with the Spanish Traza. Toussaint even speculates that Alonso Garcia Bravo himself might have executed the map in the war's wake, compelled by his own need to plan the capital of New Spain. We can see that on Benitez's book as well. The map is used to illustrate the cover, cementing this connection between the Cortes map and Spanish planning. Having demonstrated the operation of this transformative spatial consciousness in the first half of the 20th century, we're now going to turn to one particular artist and how he helped to construct a complex spatial profile for the modern city.
Okay, see Marian? Okay. So I'm going to pick up the thread of the transformative spatial consciousness that Delia discussed and invite us to consider how maps of the city animated the imagination of one member of the intellectual network we discuss in our book, the architect and artist Juan O'Gorman. Here I'm showing you portraits of the O'Gorman brothers painted in the 1930s by their father, an Irish emigre mining engineer. This was an important decade for both Juan and Edmundo. By 1938, both brothers had left their respective professions. Juan trained as an architect. By the early 1930s, he had achieved renown as a champion of architectural functionalism, as suited to the social mandates of the revolution. However, by 1938, Juan had abandoned functionalism and closed his practice, turning instead to painting, teaching, and writing. Similarly, Edmundo closed his law practice to assume the post of subdirector of the Archivo General de la Nación. But the brothers were very different. Juan was a socialist, Edmundo was not. Juan was keenly interested in Mexico's indigenous heritage and history as the fundament for a Mexican revolutionary society, while Edmundo was oriented instead towards Spanish colonial history, especially through his work at the Archivo. As Delia noted, 1938 was a watershed year in terms of historical preservation and modern urban planning. Here I show again the publications of Carlos Contreras and the Planos book by Toussaint Fernandez and Gomez de Orozco. In addition, Edmundo O'Gorman also contributed a publication for the conference, Reflexiones sobre la distribución urbana colonial de la Ciudad de México, which he dedicated to Carlos Contreras. The book was a study of five documents dating from the 16th to 18th centuries that Edmundo had located in the Archivo General, all pertaining to the Spanish Traza. Based on his study of the documents, Edmundo declared the Traza to be the, quote, ultimate urban planning solution, insofar as the Traza delineated separate areas for Spanish settlers and the city's majority indigenous inhabitants. But he also observed several fundamental spatial continuities between the post-invasion city of the 16th century and the Mexica capital. For example, the persistence of the four original barrios that divided the Mexica capital and the calzadas that connected the island capital to the lakeshore. While Edmundo's book was not illustrated with maps in the manner of the Planos volume, our curiosity was piqued when we encountered this photograph that shows Edmundo standing in front of the Cortes map. In particular, we notice that the map is rotated 180 degrees, which disrupts its relationship to the geography of the valley, as ascertained by scholars like Toussaint and Fernandez. So I'll take a cue from this manipulation of the map to invite us to think about maps as tools of imaginative projection, though I'll step away now from Edmundo and turn attention to Juan's work. Here, I juxtapose the rather straightforward portrait of Juan painted by his father with Juan's own self-portrait from 1950. While time doesn't allow me to elaborate on the self-portrait, I want to note that in her study of O'Gorman's mosaic mural on the south-facing wall of the Biblioteca Nacional at Ceú, Dr. Rita Eder observes how the 1950 self-portrait alludes to the self as divided, and to an imagination shaped by contradiction and dichotomy. We argue that Juan's depiction of Mexico City, also shown here, does similar work. I'll note that in 2007, I published an essay on this painting where I argue as much. But in the context of the spatial imaginary that Delia and I explored, our understanding of the cityscape has been greatly enriched. Time doesn't allow me to elaborate on the details of the painting. However, it's crucial to note that in 1949, the painting won first prize in a contest that invited artists to create depictions of the modern capital city. Not for nothing, two of the members of the contest jury were Manuel Toussaint and Justino Fernandez. Of crucial importance to the vista's meaning is, of course, the inclusion of the Mapa Uppsala, one of the maps that Toussaint and Fernandez studied with great care in Planos. Here we see it held aloft by the artist's own hands. While the composition seems to suggest a correlation between the 16th century city represented in the map and the modern vista arrayed before the artist and us as viewers, in fact, the map as painted and as held aloft bears an inverse relationship to the view. As an architect, there's no question that O'Gorman would have noted this contradiction. In fact, he tells us as much by adding a capital letter N to designate the geographic orientation of the map vis-a-vis north. Here I also illustrate a project that Juan undertook as a student in 1927 when he was enrolled in Carlos Contreras' seminar on urban planning. O'Gorman's project for Contreras would have provided him with expert understanding of the city's expanding historic center, the very area he depicted 20 years later in his cityscape. We can only conclude, therefore, that the map's inverse relationship to the urban geography depicted was purposeful. It was precisely during the years that he painted La Ciudad de México between 1947 and 49, that Juan was articulating a theory of organic architecture both in writing and in practice. During this time, he also shifted his attention away from the increasingly dense historical city center shown in the cityscape and turned instead toward the Pedregal, the site of the basin of Mexico's earliest human settlement, Acuicuilco. And of course, also the area that would become home to the new university city. So here I show three buildings, all built in the Pedregal, that pertain to this period: the Biblioteca Central, an architectural collaboration between O'Gorman with Juan Martinez Velasco and Gustavo Saavedra; Anahuacalli, the museum designed in collaboration with Diego Rivera to house Rivera's vast collection of Mesoamerican art; and the private home that O'Gorman designed for his family that was his most complete expression of organic architecture. Each of these structures expresses his turn toward an architectural form that he argued was rooted in the basin's geography, landscape, and history. A few more words are in order about O'Gorman's design for the library at the CEU, and those of you who attended the beautiful tour yesterday have some understanding of the mosaic's complex iconography. So here I show a period model of the functionalist 10-story building on which O'Gorman sketched out the mosaic design. We see the north wall, and then the actual building as seen from the south wall facing the campus. Note that an earlier design for the building evidently emulated the massing of a Mexica pyramid, though that design was rejected by the team overseeing the campus. The mosaic mural was designed entirely by Juan O'Gorman. South represents European knowledge and the spiritual, cultural, and intellectual conquest of Mexico, as depicted by scenes of colonization and, of course, the two monumental orbs representing the Ptolemaic geocentric and the Copernican heliocentric model. The north wall, meanwhile, is inspired and based on codical sources, and it represents indigenous cosmology in space and time. In keeping with the theme of our presentation, I'll turn focus now to the inclusion on the south wall of the Cortes map, along with another peculiar detail, a scroll held by the figure of King Charles in which appear the words Ley de Indias. The scroll refers to the body of law promulgated in the 16th century and intended to ensure the well-being of indigenous people who were subject to abuse at the hands of European settlers. Notice, however, that the words are backwards. Perceptively, Rida Eder observes that the words are on the side of the mural representing heterodox knowledge, which was the case when Copernicus was persecuted for his heliocentric model. Meanwhile, historian Luis Roberto Torres Escalona has noted this detail as well, suggesting that viewers, and evidently some scholars, have construed the reversal as a technical error resulting from the transfer of the design from cartoons into mosaic panels. He suggests that this was not the case, and that the reversed words may allude to how the Leyes de Indias were routinely disregarded. As such, he suggests the reversal relates to O'Gorman's vision of history. We agree. Let's turn then to the presentation of the Cortes map. In our review of the literature, we found no source that discussed the fact that, as presented, the map has also been manipulated spatially. We thus propose that this relates to Juan's interest in maps as devices that encode meaning as imaginative projections. As presented on the south wall, not only is the Cortes map rotated 180 degrees, like the version shown in the photograph of his brother, but it has also been flipped on the horizontal. Like the words Ley de Indias, the map is backwards. O'Gorman was meticulous in his work as an architect, painter, and writer, so these reversals were no mistake. We argue these elements express O'Gorman's imaginative projection of European knowledge as a form of epistemicide, and that a full understanding comes only through consideration of how the south wall mosaic relates to the imagery on the north side. So on the north facade, O'Gorman created a representation of indigenous cosmology derived from his study of pre- and post-invasion codical sources, including the Codex Mendoza, the Codex Borbonicus, the Codex Borgia, and other sources like the Teocalli of Sacred Warfare. Indeed, O'Gorman's intense engagement with such sources affirms that he conceived of the mosaic like a pictorial codex that unfolds and wraps around the 10-story building. And in his writing, he described it thus, though later he acknowledged the building's overall conceptual failure, and he quoted David Alfaro Siqueiro's criticism that the building was a gringa dressed as a China poblana. Regardless, let's briefly consider the imaginative games O'Gorman was playing, particularly with the detail of the Cortes map, and how these served to unify the message expressed on the two walls of the building. We argue, in fact, that the north wall, as the wall one encounters upon approaching the campus from the city, invites the viewer, nominally a student at the CEU, to adopt an indigenous cosmovision. Now imagine, after taking in the wall's imagery, that the wall dematerializes. In this way, the inverted elements on the south wall are corrected. We can now see the words Ley de Indias correctly, which we argue alludes to how an indigenous-centered perspective might right the errors of the past. And in addition, the orientation of the Cortes map is also corrected. And crucially, the map is positioned so as to orient us south toward the Pedregal, toward the earliest site of human settlement at Cuicuilco. We acknowledge that this is a complicated spatial game, and that's why we made this little model. But we are assured in our interpretation by the similar game that Juan had played in his painted vista of the city center. And here I've included a Google map, a slide, a view from Google Earth that demonstrates the relationship between the Cortes map, understood this way, and the southern end of the basin. We therefore invite consideration of a spatial imaginary wherein maps both precede and exceed the work of archaeology. And now I'll cede the last word to Delia.
By way of a very brief closure, we share here a final image, a fisheye view of the original 1964 installation of one notable wall in the Sala Mexica in the MNA, the Museo Nacional de Antropología, which shows, of course, the captivating spatial projection of Tenochtitlan, painted by Luis Covarrubias, as it continues to be seen today, as well as Ignacio Martinez's maquette of the sacred precinct in the foreground. But it also shows something no longer extant. Below Covarrubias's panorama are reproductions of the capital's earliest maps, which together create a genealogy of civic morphology. We contend that this rich spatial consciousness, which also extended originally to other cartographic images and messages around the gallery, was fueled in part by expanded access to a range of new archival materials impacting a tight network of thinkers at just the moment they were grappling with the realities of a rapidly expanding and revolutionary capital city. Thank you.
Gracias. Thank you so much, Adriana and Delia. La tercera y última presentación correrá a cargo de las coponentes Juanita Solana Roa y Blanca Serrano Ortiz de Solórzano. Juanita Solana Roa es profesora asistente del Departamento de Historia del Arte de la Universidad de los Andes. Blanca Serrano Ortiz de Solórzano es directora de proyectos en el Institute for Studies on Latin American Art, ISLA. Ambas son especialistas en arte moderno y contemporáneo de América Latina, y las dos son doctoras en Historia del Arte por the Institute of Fine Arts, NYU, donde realizaron también su maestría. Juanita y Blanca son coautoras del proyecto de Humanidades Digitales, La Fiebre del Banano, Banana Craze. Juntas han comisariado las exposiciones Banana Craze y Bitter Tastes, Tracing the Fruit Market in the Global South. And as a note, Blanca is joining us over Zoom. So let's welcome Juanita and Blanca.
Bueno, gracias. Mientras abrimos la presentación, gracias a todos los organizadores y gracias a ustedes por aguantar hasta esta ponencia de este congreso, pues que ha sido maravilloso.
vamos a poner acá screen. Ahí está.
Muy bien. Bueno, nuestra ponencia se titula La fiebre del banano, Banana Craze, entre exposición virtual y archivo digital. El banano es hoy en día la fruta más consumida en el mundo, pero hace un siglo apenas era conocido fuera de sus países de cultivo. Nuestro proyecto de humanidades digitales, La fiebre del banano, Banana Craze, investiga cómo el monocultivo masivo de esta fruta ha transformado la economía y sociedad, el medio ambiente y la identidad de Centroamérica y el Caribe desde hace más de 100 años. Este proyecto, que inició como una curaduría, se convirtió no solo en una exposición digital, sino también en un archivo que permite la exploración tanto de las obras de arte que contiene como del proyecto de investigación en sí mismo. Y acá quiero como recalcar que, a diferencia de la mayoría de los proyectos que hemos visto y de las investigaciones que se han expuesto en este proyecto, nuestra idea es lo contrario. En vez de explorar un archivo, pues esto se ha convertido en la creación de un archivo. A continuación, entonces, les presentaremos primero lo que investiga la fiebre del banano, para posteriormente mostrarles el carácter de doble archivo que contiene la página web, así como la multiplicidad de lecturas que se despliegan a partir del formato digital de la plataforma. Entonces, ¿qué investiga la fiebre del banano, Banana Craze? La fiebre del banano es el primer gran estudio de cómo un recurso natural como el banano ha forjado el pasado y el presente de un continente y cómo este fenómeno se expresa a través de la cultura. La fiebre del banano reúne hasta el momento, es un proyecto que sigue creciendo, aproximadamente 100 obras de arte contemporáneo latinoamericano en las que el banano es el protagonista. Partiendo de la fotografía del cubano Raúl Corrales, titulada Caballería, de 1960, en la que un grupo de hombres cabalga victorioso celebrando la expropiación de las plantaciones de la United Fruit Company por parte del gobierno revolucionario, la investigación de la fiebre del banano llega hasta el presente y continúa en constante desarrollo. El estudio de estas obras permite comprender, desde una perspectiva artística, cultural y filosófica, cómo el cultivo masivo del banano contribuyó al aumento de las desigualdades sociales en América Latina, alteró las formas de vida tradicionales locales y transformó el paisaje y el medio ambiente en la región, además de contribuir a la configuración de estereotipos xenófobos, racistas y sexistas sobre sus habitantes. El banano fue una fruta prácticamente desconocida por fuera de sus espacios de producción hasta finales del siglo XIX, en dramático contraste con la situación actual. Hoy en día, el banano no es solamente una fruta muy común, sino que también ocupa un lugar destacado en la cultura popular global. Así lo demuestran, por ejemplo, desde el banano adherido a la pared con cinta pegante que Mauricio Catalán vendió por $120,000 en Art Basel, Miami, en 2019, y la gente pues, que visitaba la feria hacía fila para tomarse fotos con el banano, hasta el popular jingle comercial de Chiquita Banana. Pero, ¿cómo ha llegado esta fruta a convertirse en ícono de la violencia, fetiche sexual y símbolo de lo exótico y lo subdesarrollado? Este proyecto de investigación busca indagar sobre las políticas sociales, económicas y culturales que el cultivo masivo del banano generó en el continente americano, particularmente en América Latina y el Caribe, a través del arte contemporáneo. Las casi 100 obras que forman parte de este proyecto desenmascaran y examinan las relaciones de poder y tensiones establecidas entre el norte y el sur del continente a partir de los diferentes roles que jugaron los cultivadores, exportadores y consumidores. Más que una exhibición virtual, este es un espacio de investigación activo, creciente y en constante desarrollo. De hecho, estamos justamente en este momento en una segunda etapa de investigación y planeamos subir a la plataforma alrededor de 50 obras más que hemos empezado a investigar desde que lanzamos el proyecto en el 2021. En la actualidad, el banano es la fruta que más se consume a nivel global, con una producción estimada de 116 millones de toneladas al año. Si bien el mayor consumo de la fruta se da a nivel local, pues forma parte de la dieta básica de los diferentes países que lo producen, su exportación también es masiva y genera alrededor de 12 billones de dólares al año. América Latina y el Caribe son la segunda región productora de bananos del mundo, después de Asia, pero la región aporta alrededor del 75% de las exportaciones mundiales. La producción de bananos en Ecuador, por ejemplo, representa el 30% de la oferta mundial. El banano es la fruta más cultivada en el subcontinente americano, seguida por la piña, el mango, el aguacate y la papaya. Un 80% de las exportaciones están dirigidas hacia los países desarrollados, principalmente en Europa y Estados Unidos, lo que ilustra la desigual relación de dependencia que examinan numerosas de las obras incluidas en este proyecto. La metodología de la fiebre del banano parece seguir la máxima de Patrick Svensson, quien define las humanidades digitales como herramienta, como objeto de estudio, como medio de expresión, como laboratorio experimental y como lugar de activismo. Efectivamente, este proyecto de investigación aúna una exposición, un archivo, un repertorio de publicaciones y una serie de programas públicos para tejer una red en constante crecimiento en torno al legado cultural del monocultivo del banano en Latinoamérica. Tras un polémico artículo publicado en Hyperallergic en el otoño del 2021 sobre cómo el florecimiento de exposiciones virtuales surgidas a raíz de la pandemia habitualmente no ofrecían nada distinto ni mejor a una exposición presencial, Seth Rodney se corrigió a sí mismo seleccionando tres exposiciones virtuales que, según él, sí merecían ser visitadas. Junto a una muestra del Getty y otra de Google Arts and Culture, Rodney seleccionó la fiebre del banano. Rodney describe el proyecto como, y lo cito, una indagación histórica profunda, un gran proyecto de investigación que hace uso del medio digital para mostrar imágenes y textos en formas que uno no podría experimentar en la vida real. Uno se asoma a la plataforma como un abismo repleto de infinidad de maneras para presentar y relacionar la información. Cierro cita. En efecto, la fiebre del banano demuestra que las humanidades digitales sirven para crear herramientas de conocimiento totalmente nuevas, aplicando perspectivas académicas originales combinadas con métodos innovadores de visualización de datos que permiten comunicar de manera eficaz y sugerente los hallazgos de una investigación. En este sentido, las humanidades digitales proporcionan la exploración de distintos tipos de fuentes documentales y bases de datos que presentados en un formato no digital serían demasiado opacos o poco manejables. Es decir, que las humanidades digitales posibilitan narrar aquello que de otra forma sería difícil de presentar, abarcar o comprender, tanto para el público académico como para el no especializado. Como ocurre en la fiebre del banano, estos proyectos también deben tener un carácter abierto que permita que tanto las herramientas disponibles para el usuario como los datos presentados se sientan parte de un patrimonio común y abierto del que cada uno puede añadir, sustraer, relaborar y recombinar. La fiebre del banano evita la recopilación meramente enciclopédica de imágenes y textos. En cambio, la plataforma explora las numerosas y creativas posibilidades de presentación visual de contenidos y datos que ofrece la tecnología, en tanto la cotejación de datos geográficos y cronológicos de la sección de archivo, como en una exposición virtual donde el encuentro con las obras de arte siempre es en relación con otras piezas y contextos y nunca en un recorrido forzosamente lineal ni impuesto previamente al usuario. Así, este proyecto parece responder eficazmente a la cuestión formulada por Paul B. Jascot, y lo cito. La pregunta no es qué puede hacer la historia del arte con lo digital, la pregunta es cuáles son las cuestiones importantes de la historia del arte que pueden abordarse con la ayuda de las herramientas digitales. Cierro cita. En la fiebre del banano encontramos cómo, en efecto, primero la investigación histórico-artística está en el centro de la plataforma y después el uso de las nuevas tecnologías se articula en torno a esta investigación. A través de distintos ejes temáticos de la exposición virtual y de los distintos parámetros de búsqueda para cotejar las obras de arte, en la sección de archivo, la fiebre del banano refleja la afirmación de Laia Meeks de que la visualización y la historia espacial no consisten en producir ilustraciones o mapas para comunicar cosas que se han descubierto por otros medios, sino que son un medio de investigación en sí mismo. Como ha estudiado Isabel Galina, este proyecto aúna metodologías propias de las disciplinas como la tecnología, las ciencias de la información y las ciencias de la computación para alcanzar un resultado único y original en el que el tema de la investigación y las herramientas para analizarlo son inseparables. Entonces, ahora voy a pasar la palabra a Blanca, que nos acompaña por Zoom, y les voy a compartir.
¿Se me oye?
Sí, te oímos perfecto. Espérate.
Genial.
Paso a la página web. Acá está. ¿Está? Ahí está, perfecto. Sí, gracias. Adelante, Blanca.
Muchas gracias, Juanita. Pues ahora vamos a hacer un breve recorrido por la sección dedicada a la exposición. ¿Se me oye bien?
Sí.
Para enfocarnos en lo que nosotras llamamos el doble archivo. Como decía Juanita, este proyecto no estudia un archivo preexistente, sino que supone la creación de un archivo. Y hablamos de doble archivo porque el proyecto incluye la base de datos de 100 obras de arte que configuran la exposición, pero también una serie de publicaciones, bibliografía, recursos y muchos programas públicos en línea que han ido construyendo en paralelo otro archivo que amplíe la investigación de una manera interdisciplinar y transversal. Entonces, la exposición está dividida en tres galerías, que digamos emulan las galerías físicas que uno encontraría en un museo en persona, que están organizadas temáticamente según violencias, identidades y ecosistemas. Esos son los tres temas que organizan las 100 obras de arte. La sección dedicada a las violencias reúne una serie de obras que exploran la larga historia de abusos vivida en el continente americano en relación al monocultivo del banano, ejercida principalmente por corporaciones multinacionales extranjeras y los estados corruptos de las regiones donde se instauraron los enclaves. Básicamente, las obras de la sección violencias son obras que tienen que ver con la presencia de la United Fruit Company en Centroamérica y en el Caribe. Pero las violencias vividas por los trabajadores de las compañías y las comunidades locales no se limitaron al ámbito político. En la cotidianidad, aún hoy los trabajadores de las bananeras trabajan sin medidas sanitarias suficientes que protejan sus cuerpos de la exposición a pesticidas, y el arduo trabajo manual que llevan a cabo día a día es arduo y los salarios son apenas simbólicos. Las condiciones laborales rayan en la explotación. Las obras agrupadas en esta sección reflexionan sobre todos estos tipos de violencia, pero a su vez no se limitan al señalamiento de una violencia ejercida sobre los cuerpos, sino que también habla de la violencia ejercida sobre la naturaleza, o sobre las diferentes identidades que se desprenden de la intervención tan directa de las compañías bananeras en los países intervenidos. De ahí que el formato digital de esta exposición sea tan importante, porque nos permite enfatizar las múltiples capas de lectura que una misma obra puede despertar. Es decir, que una obra podría estar en la sección de la exposición titulada Violencias, pero también en la sección de la exposición titulada Ecosistemas, porque alude a más de un tema, digamos. En ese sentido, la visitante de la fibra del banano pues, se encuentra con obras que están simultáneamente en más de una galería, lo que sería imposible, obviamente, en el espacio físico de una exposición. La sección de ecosistemas está organizada en torno a este término, este concepto del medio ambiente, y esta sección reúne piezas que tienen que ver efectivamente con el impacto del monocultivo del banano en cuestiones medioambientales. Fundamentalmente el problema es el uso de pesticidas y agroquímicos que causan problemas graves de salud, sobre todo respiratorios, pero también de fertilidad en los trabajadores de las plantaciones bananeras, y también cómo el monocultivo impacta la economía, dado que todo se juega a una sola carta, a cultivar solamente banano y no diversifica la agricultura y, por tanto, la economía local, y también, por lo tanto, las implicaciones que eso tiene en el paisaje y en la identidad cultural. Y la sección de identidades recoge obras que exploran la construcción de la identidad latinoamericana, centroamericana y del Caribe en torno al tropo del plátano o del banano, que van desde la identificación con la nación, donde, por ejemplo, el cliché, el estereotipo racista y clasista de la República Bananera, la Banana Republic, está muy presente, y también está el banano entendido como un vehículo de identidad cultural, laboral, racial y sexual. Muchas veces encontramos obras en las que el banano parece según la metáfora del cuerpo latinoamericano, como un cuerpo hipersexual, blando, vago. Ahí también jugó un papel importante la figura de Carmen Miranda, personificando al plátano ya femenino de por sí, que era la chiquita banana, que era el logotipo de la United Fruit Company. En último, lo que queremos señalar con todo esto es que el formato digital de la construcción de una serie de salas o de galerías organizadas bajo ejes temáticos específicos no limita, bajo ninguna circunstancia, la multiplicidad de capas de lectura que las obras de arte contienen. Por el contrario, al tratarse de una exposición digital, esto posibilita y abre caminos de interpretación para múltiples narrativas desde una misma estructura. Por lo que comentaba anteriormente, que una obra puede estar en más de un eje temático. Y ahora les vamos a mostrar como el fichero y el mosaico que también agrupa las obras. Es decir, tenemos 100 obras de arte que se pueden visitar como una exposición en tres galerías temáticas, pero que también se pueden consultar como una base de datos. Por eso también hablamos de una exposición como un archivo con 100 obras de arte. Entonces, la manera más lineal, quizá la más evidente, sería investigar esto como un archivo. Aquí veis como las tarjetitas de un archivo antiguo, donde uno puede consultar alfabéticamente por apellido los artistas participantes del proyecto y las obras de arte de cada uno. Perdón, que no quiero perder el hilo. Y luego, todas las obras también se pueden ver como un gran mosaico, como si fuera un gran tablero de Pinterest, donde uno ve todos los iconos de las 100 obras de arte, de manera que también las podría buscar, digamos, gráficamente o visualmente por la imagen de cada una de las obras y no necesariamente por su autor. Entonces, esta herramienta, como expone Lev Manovich en su libro The Language of the Media, en la viabilidad digital y las posibilidades con este tipo de plataformas radican en la multiplicidad de accesos posibles al mismo conjunto de datos. En este caso, como hemos mostrado, se pueden investigar por temática, por autoría y por imagen como por thumbnail, imagen de la obra. Pero quizá lo más interesante del proyecto en esta sección es que también las obras se pueden investigar cronológicamente y geográficamente. La cronología es esta línea de tiempo que está mostrando Juanita, que comienza con la fotografía de Raúl Corrales, que muestra la expropiación de la última plantación de la UFC en Cuba en 1960, y termina con la obra de Justin Favela, que reinterpreta una obra icónica del artista puertorriqueño Francisco Oyer en clave de una piñata mexicana de papel, y que es una obra realizada en 2021. Otra de las últimas obras del proyecto se realizó el verano antes de que saliera a luz nuestro proyecto en una residencia de artista. Es decir, que hemos intentado también incluir obras famosas, digamos, de autores y autoras muy conocidos, pero también obras de creación muy reciente, para que el abanico de artistas fuera amplio, diverso, y que no fuéramos nosotras quienes escogiéramos quién era merecedor de entrar o no, sino que incluir todas las obras que nos parecía que respondían a estos temas. Entonces, la cronología lo que permite es una investigación no lineal, porque a la visitante que consulte la página web se le abre la posibilidad de sacar sus propias conclusiones sobre esta base de datos de 100 obras de arte. Por ejemplo, uno podría ver si en los últimos años las obras de los artistas más jóvenes tratan sobre cuestiones medioambientales, porque eso preocupa más hoy en día, mientras que en los 70s y los 80s se alude más al banano como una referencia a la República Bananera en el contexto de las dictaduras latinoamericanas y ese tipo de cuestiones más políticas. Y de manera similar, en el mapa uno puede ver las 100 obras de arte distribuidas en este caso geográficamente por el país de origen. Entonces, si uno, por ejemplo, clica en Colombia, ve la lista de obras que son de artistas colombianos, y en este caso, por ejemplo, hemos observado que muchos artistas en Colombia hablan de un suceso tristemente conocido en la historia colombiana, que es la masacre de las bananeras, que ocurrió en 1928, en la que, por, digamos, indicación de la compañía bananera, el gobierno masacró a cientos o miles de trabajadores que protestaban por derechos laborales más justos. Y también en Colombia, por ejemplo, uno ve que muchos artistas ligan una historia de violencias que origina en la colonia y en las bananas y termina con la historia de la guerrilla y el narcotráfico en el presente. Y, por ejemplo, en el Caribe, en República Dominicana, pues las obras, en cambio, suelen tener que ver con cuestiones de identidad. Y el banano aquí suele hacer alusión a la identidad migrante compartida, una identidad en diáspora. Que hace referencia al Caribe y que utiliza el tropo del banano como algo que en un momento, por ejemplo, en Nueva York era un insulto para referirse a las personas de origen caribeño y que hoy en día se exhibe como un símbolo de orgullo e identidad cultural. Y ya para ir terminando, lo que explicamos al comienzo de nuestra presentación es que el archivo, digamos, no existía, sino que lo hemos generado nosotras creando esa base de datos de 100 obras de arte, pero también se ha ido generando de manera muy orgánica y en paralelo un archivo de contenidos interdisciplinares que han ido surgiendo sobre todo a través de los eventos que hemos organizado en línea desde que se lanzó el proyecto. Desde octubre del 2021, cuando lanzamos la plataforma de la Fiebre del Banano, hemos realizado más de una decena de eventos online, siempre el acceso libre y gratuito, y todos además quedan siempre colgados en la página web en vídeo, de manera que uno podría ver los vídeos más tarde. Y aquí hemos invitado a académicos y profesores de universidad, por supuesto a muchísimos artistas participantes del proyecto, a realizar charlas, ponencias, conversatorios. Hemos tenido también un taller impartido por una artista brasileña, Daniela Serrulla Con, que enseñó al público cómo realizar papel a través de la piel del banano y a realizar vinagre a través del banano. Hemos realizado dos ciclos de cine documental. Localizamos 6 o 7 películas de cine documental buenísimas de los últimos años sobre las bananeras y conseguimos los derechos para hacer dos festivales de cine online durante una semana. Y bueno, todo esto, esta serie de programas que hemos desarrollado en paralelo, nos parece que han nutrido el proyecto porque lo abrían y lo convertían en una conversación más coral, en la que no éramos solamente Juanita y yo hablando con nuestra perspectiva, sino que queríamos que fuera más horizontal y más permeable a las especialidades y disciplinas de otros expertos en la materia. Y por eso es más interdisciplinar o transdisciplinar, porque ha incluido cine, también charlas medioambientales, también tuvimos la presentación de un periodista que ha trabajado sobre los archivos de la United Fruit Company, programas de distintos tipos, y finalmente esta sección como de archivo complementario a la investigación incluye también una serie de publicaciones. Tenemos una sección de blog con textos más breves y más informales en español sobre el banano en la cultura popular, más allá del arte contemporáneo latinoamericano. Pues, por ejemplo, aquí hay cuestiones que tienen que ver con las Guerrilla Girls o con Andy Warhol. Y también tenemos una sección con publicaciones académicas que son de autoría de Juanita y mías. Por ahora tenemos un artículo publicado en Post, como en la revista digital del MoMA, pero tenemos también 2 capítulos de 2 libros en proceso que iremos colgando aquí. Entonces, digamos, esta es otra manera, además de los vídeos de nuestros eventos, con estas publicaciones también complementamos el proyecto de investigación y armamos este archivo de investigación en paralelo a la exposición. Y por último, también estamos acumulando un archivo de hemeroteca, digamos, en el que reunimos todas las menciones en prensa que ha recibido el proyecto, que son muchas. Hemos salido en medios internacionales, en Estados Unidos, en México, Uruguay, Colombia, España. Numerosos medios han recogido el proyecto, lo cual nos ilusiona mucho. Y luego, por supuesto, como buenas académicas, contamos también con una bibliografía que también está siempre en constante desarrollo y en crecimiento. Y bueno, y ese es el proyecto. Muchas gracias.
Gracias.
Thank you so much, Juanita and Blanca, for your presentation. I think, do we have a few minutes for questions? Oh. Yeah? Okay, great. So maybe just invite the presenters back, please.
Thank you all for those really fantastic, informative presentations. My question is for Doctoras Cosentino and Zavala. I can't wait to read the book when it comes out. But I wanted to ask if you deal with the desagüe, and if Toussaint Fernandez and Contreras in, you know, the period of the 20th century and the work that they were doing were dealing still, you know, as urban planners and historians of the city, with the effects of the desagüe and also the overexploitation of the aquifer of the Valley of Mexico. Thank you.
That's a wonderful question, but no, we don't deal with it this way.
A few of the maps, of course, do have to do with water, so we touch upon it, but not as part of their project.
But if you have information that you think is pertinent to the period, please email us.
Thank you.
Muchas gracias por la presentación. Mi pregunta es para Idurre. Habías mencionado que durante esta intervención del archivo trabajaron con ciertos grupos, ¿no? Entre ellos los jardineros, ¿no? Pero no sé si también hubo otros grupos con los que participaron. Eso por una parte, no sé si solo fueron los jardineros nada más. Y también, sobre todo, preguntarte a ti a modo personal, o sea, como, ¿cómo vives la paradoja de ser una mujer española trabajando en una colección latinoamericana de Estados Unidos, ¿no? O sea, ¿cómo vives esos desplazamientos, esas contradicciones? ¿Cómo defiendes lo indefendible en ese sentido, ¿no?
Había varios grupos con los que trabajé, lo dije durante la presentación. Trabajé con Yesa Calderón, que es una autora Shumasitonga de California, con Lilia Ramírez, que es parte de Mujeres del Maíz, una artista chicana, y con Jorge Gutiérrez, que es fundador de Familia TQLM, que es una organización que trabaja con inmigrantes latinos trans y queer. Entonces sí, o sea, sí trabajé con otras personas, aparte de los jardineros. En cuanto a tu pregunta, yo llevo 20 años trabajando con arte latinoamericano. A mí no me causa ningún tipo de problema esta cuestión. Quiero decir que yo no considero que uno tiene que ser de un país para trabajar el arte de ese país, porque si no yo tendría que dedicarme a trabajar arte vasco, ¿no? Entonces, no me provoca ningún problema. Entiendo las problemáticas que existen dentro de Estados Unidos sobre el arte latinoamericano, soy muy consciente de ello, trabajando desde el Getty además. Y yo soy muy cuidadosa con lo que hago, sobre todo cuando se trata de adquisiciones. Y considero, por supuesto, que los archivos deberían quedarse en su lugar de origen, cosa que me causa un problema a mí, ¿verdad? Porque yo estoy trabajando en un archivo desde Estados Unidos, pero también hay que entender las problemáticas de cada país en cuanto a situaciones en que tenemos organización, o sea, no tenemos instituciones que se hagan cargo, y ante eso yo prefiero que un archivo que se va a perder en su lugar de origen acabe en el Getty, que además por lo menos tenemos la posibilidad de dar becas y que esté abierto el archivo. Pero entiendo, o sea, tengo un montón de problemas éticos respecto a eso.
Okay. I think we have a question on this side. Get you the microphone. Sure.
Mi pregunta es para Juanita y Blanca. Gracias por compartir la página. ¿Podríamos pensar que este proyecto se podría haber quedado como en arte moderno o en algún momento, pero como ustedes lo están estirando a artistas contemporáneos? Quisiera saber si hay alguna respuesta de los artistas en cuanto a esta reunión, que podríamos decir como morfológica o temática, en cuanto a utilizar la figura del plátano para crear el catálogo de imágenes, si ha habido como alguna objeción a ser acotado dentro de este término o en otro sentido, si han sido invitados o si ellos han continuado con esta temática o han desarrollado bajo la inquietud que ustedes están planteando.
Sí, gracias. No, realmente lo que ha pasado es que desde que lanzamos la página nos han escrito no sé cuántos artistas emocionados por encontrarse con el proyecto y compartiéndonos su trabajo, de ahí que justamente pues hayamos decidido en avanzar con una segunda etapa de investigación y de inclusión del proyecto y que inesperadamente se haya empezado a convertir en una especie de archivo. Nosotras nunca pensamos que esto iba a convertirse en un archivo y curiosamente esa ha sido la reacción al proyecto, y pues estamos muy contentas de que lo podamos continuar.
Okay, and are there any final questions? May I ask any questions? Okay. Bueno, thank you everybody for coming. Thank you to the panelists. Oh, I'm sorry, do we have one? Oh, I'm so sorry, Luis, please.
Felicidades a la mesa. Es muy sencilla la pregunta y es para Idurre, Juanita y Blanca, y tiene que ver con recepción, es decir, ¿cuál fue el efecto en el público y cómo estas curadurías experimentales en el formato digital o en el formato de pensarlas colaborativamente son recibidas y cómo dan cuenta de eso para integrarlo al propio archivo en el caso del banano o para cambiar las políticas de exhibición en el GRI de forma mucho más radical?
Pues por nuestro lado la recepción ha sido buenísima, o sea, esto ha crecido de una forma que nosotras no nos lo esperábamos, honestamente. Nos han, lo que contaba Blanca, el proyecto ha salido en la prensa en muchísimos lugares, nos han invitado a participar en podcasts, en proyectos de televisión, en otras páginas web. Entonces ha sido realmente muy bonito darnos cuenta cómo pues una fruta se ha convertido en algo de este tamaño. Tenemos también un proyecto paralelo que es el Instagram del proyecto, que lo pueden seguir, es BananaCraze2021, en donde acompañamos parte de la investigación con cosas actuales que están sucediendo. Por ejemplo, no sé si vieron hace poco el reality show del Hirshhorn Museum con MTV, que una de las primeras obras que se hicieron fue un banano gigante. Y entonces es como si el tema fuera inagotable. Y lo que nosotras queremos hacer pues es brindar una perspectiva crítica precisamente a esto, y creo que eso es lo que ha permitido que el proyecto tenga esa recepción tan positiva.
Bueno, en mi caso, el tema de recepción, bueno, es una buena pregunta, Luis, y algo que yo no traté, tenía poco tiempo. Hay un tema aquí que yo no hablé, que el Getty es un lugar sumamente tradicional, que tiene una percepción, sobre todo en Los Ángeles, como un lugar de élite tradicional, que está en una montaña, que es todo blanco, que muestra arte europeo. Entonces, hacer una exposición como Reinventing en el Getty tiene otro significado que no lo tendría si esa exposición hubiese sido hecha en LACMA o en MoCA, ¿no? Y eso ha sido lo que ha generado una recepción muy buena, tanto desde dentro, quiero decir que de repente el staff del museo curatorial se dio cuenta que se pueden hacer las cosas de otra manera, inclusive lo que hablaba del tema del diseño de la exposición, que eso también... no lo pude tratar, pero es un diseño muy contemporáneo que no es común en el Getty. Eso también fue un quiebre, ¿no? Entonces me parece que lo importante de esta exposición, aparte que sí tuvo una recepción muy buena entre el público, tiene su importancia dentro de la institución, porque me parece que va a dar la posibilidad para otros curadores para pensar que las cosas se pueden hacer de otra manera y salir un poco de todo esto, ¿no? Y ahora igual me echan, pero ahí está.
Okay, so thank you again, everybody. So we have a brief break of around 20 minutes, and I'd like to invite you all back for the keynote by Sandy Rodriguez at 6 o'clock.